Ooh, I didn't know that there was some sticky stuff on my laptop that I got. Hold on.
Are you peeling something off right now?
There's.
I can hear it.
That could be taken in a very dirty context.
I'll make sure to remix this all up.
There is like a plastic thing between every single key on this keyboard. And I
Whoa.
just peeled it off and it was like a grid. It's crazy, crazy. Maybe that I should have left that there. I mean, I don't know. That could have been protecting something. I don't know. Anyway, well, it's off now, so I guess I won't worry about it.
That's good.
All right.
Well,
So you want me to start?
you'll figure it out.
I'll figure it out if my keys start malfunctioning. All right. You want me to start the episode, Truman?
Sure.
Hello. Welcome.
Great start.
Yep, we are the Chatmen, and today we have yet another special guest. His name is Hayden. Say hi, Hayden.
We have a special guest. Oh, hi. Hi.
Yeah.
I'm Hayden.
Yeah,
I guess
him.
I'm a special guest.
Yeah, he's the special guestman, and we have a decade of questions. Yeah. We have a decade of questions. Just ready to.
A decade.
Oh, by the way, it is New Year's Day right now. It is 46 minutes into the day.
Yeah.
Of the first January day of the 2014. And
Happy New Year, time. Everyone.
What's that, Truman?
I said, what a good time.
Yeah, I know. And what was that, Hayden?
I said, Happy New Year, everyone.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Let's
Happy
start
New Year.
The year off with terrible non-content. The most high quality non-content.
Non-tent. There you go. All right, Truman. Sorry.
Hayden, I don't know if you have listened to past episodes. I know everybody
I have.
Listens to them. So, Hayden's
our number one fan. What are you talking
about?
Oh,
yeah, that's right.
He's the one that draws the pictures for us when we're feeling down and don't have any people respond to our stuff at all. He's the one who's blessed us with all the drawings that we put on our Facebook page.
All
six
two
of them.
Drawings.
But basically, Phil and I are going to take turns asking you questions, and if I ask a question, Phil has to give your answer, Hayden. He's got to guess what you would answer these questions. So I'm going to go first this time, because I'm special, and Phil's been going first a lot.
Yeah.
So, Phil, what is Hayden's favorite Pokemon?
Oh, of course. Hayden's favorite Pokemon. From when we were in the 4th and 5th grade together, I recall that his favorite Pokemon was either Poliwhirl or Charmeleon. I believe that's what he said that it was back then, but I'm not 100% certain now.
Do you think his tastes have changed at all since he's matured
perhaps,
a little bit?
Perhaps. I could still see him liking a water Pokemon. Which Poliwhirl is one. So let me think. What is something that Hayden would like? I don't know. Actually, no, I don't think he's changed his mind since then, just because I think it's pretty much the same. Let me see. Hayden, is your answer Poliwhirl or Charmeleon as I think it was back then?
You're very close. It is a water Pokemon, but it is also a Pokemon that is kind of like Charmeleon. I'm a very big fan of Totodile. So you're kind of halfway in the middle.
Okay.
Totodile's just an adorable little ball of anger.
Wasn't that right that you did like Poliwhirl and Charmeleon back then?
I do. I do like Charmeleon and I do like Poliwhirl, but Totodile is just a little bit higher on the list.
Yeah. I like
Feralgut is great. Can't even fit his name in the whole Pokemon.
We said that.
With the
so
Pokey
cool.
and the Mon.
Let me see. Do you like Charmeleon more than Charizard?
I do, actually, yes.
Me too, me too.
It. Well,
I don't know why. I just love them.
It's probably the angst. The youth, if you remember in the show, Charmeleon was all broody and
the
angsty.
Teenage angst.
Yeah, and what's his name? Charizard was always just lazy and whatever.
He was like, I'm too cool for this. But back then, Charmeleon was like, I got something to prove. I'm too good.
Yeah, and he had the big old chameleon two-finger things. We just spike you with. It's awesome. It's my question now. So, yeah. Truman, when playing Mario Kart, who do you think Hayden's favorite go-to character is?
All right. Is Hayden a mainstream picker, or does he pick, you know, the people that don't get enough love, like maybe a Dry Bones or a Waluigi? I'm actually thinking that maybe Hayden likes to go for the bigger guys, like maybe a Donkey Kong or a Bowser. I'm going with Bowser. I think you're a big Bowser driver.
I think you're right.
That is correct.
I would.
I'd like to say that I do main Bowser, but when I'm not playing Bowser, it's Dry Bones. Those are my two favorites.
I'm good. I knew it.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, the heavy characters are what I go for, because they might start slow, but they're the fastest in the long game.
The acceleration, that's pretty slow, but they're like, they go really fast.
I always pick
Waluigi. And I'm so good that I never slow down.
Whoa.
I pick Waluigi because somebody's got to pick him, and I'll be that guy.
It's Waluigi time.
He's
2014,
so
the year of Waluigi.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
The year Nintendo goes bankrupt. All right, Phil. Ethan's least favorite vegetable to eat?
Oh, my gosh. I would say artichokes. Like, I think everyone's least favorite vegetable should be.
It's not my least favorite vegetable.
Huh?
It's not my least favorite vegetable.
Okay.
Just saying.
Really think that artichokes are the worst vegetables that are in the world that exist. But let me think. What else do I not like that Hayden probably doesn't like either? Squash. Squash kind of sucks.
Squash is pretty good. You cook it right.
I'm just going to go ahead and say artichokes, because I still think that's the most disgusting vegetable there ever is. So, Hayden, do you share my opinion? And is artichokes the worst vegetable that has ever come into being?
Well, artichokes are pretty bad, but I'd say more the zucchini. I don't like.
Oh, yeah.
Ugh, gross.
Especially fried. That's the worst.
Oh, God.
And they give me headaches, is why I don't like them. I mean, other vegetables might not taste good, but if food gives me a headache, then it's automatically, no, I'm not doing
that. The worst. Yeah, the worst. What were you saying that's worse than artichokes?
The worst. The worst vegetable ever.
The worst.
The worst. The worst vegetable in existence are Brussels sprouts. They're like Satan's testicles. They are disgusting.
I don't remember what Brussels sprouts are.
Bitter. They're just bitter. There's nothing good. You like, it's, I don't know. They've got, you bite into them and this little bitter juice squirts out of them. Ugh. They're so bad. They're gross.
Just like Satan's testicles.
Yeah.
You bite into it and bitter juice comes out.
Gross, nasty, bitter juice.
Oh, God.
All right, Phil.
Oh, yeah. What do you think Hayden's favorite potato chip is? I don't know.
I don't think it would be anything boring, like classic Lay's, because those are boring, or Fritos. I don't know. I feel like maybe Hayden's a sour cream and onion fan, or possibly a barbecue.
Yeah.
I've listed, like, all the flavors of chips by this point.
pretty much.
Cheese is the other one.
Yeah, there's nacho cheese, and then there's the, like, weird hot sauce ones.
Gross.
Or the, yeah, the spicy, whatever, the salsa ones, whatever.
Sea salt vinegar.
Oh, I freaking love those.
No, bleh.
Yeah, that's, freaking great.
Those are the Brussels sprouts of potato chips.
You can count sea salt vinegar out.
Yeah.
I'm not using that.
Oh, man, it's freaking nice. It's just like
you're, I just can't take vinegar.
It's like tasting the sea. It's like you're going out in the ocean and you just open your mouth and it's like, yum.
Yeah, it may taste like the sea, but it tastes like dead fish. It's just nasty. It's gross.
Isn't that the only kind of fish we eat?
I mean, like ones that have just been left in tepid water and just have gone off a little bit. It's gross. They're oily. Ugh. Anyway, Hayden, sour cream and onion. That's it. I'm picking that.
Sour cream and onion, good, but I would have to say basic normal A's are my favorite.
Oh, boring.
Boring. I know it's boring.
Yes.
Do you mix it up and get Ruffles sometimes?
No, I don't like Ruffles. Ruffles are boring.
So you don't even like texture.
I just want a basic potato chip. I'd also look to point out that Fritos are corn chips, not potato chips.
Yeah. Chips are chips.
If we're talking just chips, I'd say Cheeto Puffs, but we're talking potato chips.
Well, no, all chips.
And Cheetos Puffs.
You don't like crunchy?
Delicious. The crunchy ones are good, but I like the Puffs way more because there's more of them. There's more of them.
Alright, so Phil, God, we have just so many food questions lined up one after the other. I didn't even mean to do this when I wrote these questions out.
What the heck, man?
What is...
Welcome to the Foodmen podcast.
I love food.
And...
Yep, I'm your chef host, Phil, and this is...
I'm the sous chef.
Yep, exactly. And today we're going to be talking to you about the wonderful world of chips and ice cream and vegetables and beverages.
So, what is Hayden's favorite beverage?
Let's see. Last time I guessed root beer, Sam was like, "Oh no, that's disgusting," and I was like, "What the heck? Why? What the heck?" But let me see. This time I'm gonna have to go with root beer, because it's freaking delicious. And
boring and stupid. I hate it.
What do you mean?
Root beer is always really lackluster to me.
Why? What are you talking about? It doesn't make any sense.
Every time I drink root beer, I'm like, this is so close to being a delicious cola. I'd rather have a cola.
Oh my god. Hayden, am I correct? Please say that I am. You are a root beer fan.
I'd say you're not incorrect. I do like root beer, but it's not my favorite.
Okay.
Well, I mean,
I just needed needed you to say that you liked it at least because Sam
I like it. I like
Sam and Truman last time were just like, "What the heck? This stuff's disgusting." And I was like, "What? What are you talking about? Why?"
I don't dislike root beer, but I will take basically everything before I'll drink root beer.
Okay. Even water?
Yeah, probably.
That's okay. That's
ice cold water over.
That's when you start getting insulting. Yeah.
Ice cold. That's boring. Ice cold water.
You're calling root beer boring, but then water is just the most boring drink.
Water is necessary, sir.
The most boring drink you can have.
It's about as necessary as Ruffles.
Yeah, Ruffles are good. You can like break them at the little ridges in your mouth.
Disgusting.
So, favorite drink, what is it?
Whatever. I don't really have a favorite. I prefer Pepsi, I guess.
Yeah. I like Pepsi more than I like Coke. But I like Diet Coke a lot because it has all the caffeine that I need. I've gotten addicted to it. Don't tell anyone though. I'm trying to kick the habit.
You gonna get
all that caffeine's making me crazy, man. What?
Get that Diet Coke patch and put it on.
Yep.
Wean off.
Yep, and then I could just drink root beer in the meantime.
Go to
that stuff doesn't have any caffeine.
Addict Anonymous.
Yep, DC A.
CA. Diet Coke Anonymous.
All right, Phil. Next question.
All right. Who is Hayden's favorite member of the Avengers? Go.
Well. I breathed in too deep through my teeth. All right, let's stay.
Careful there. Careful, careful.
I don't think it's Hawkeye because nobody likes Hawkeye. He's boring.
He's a hot guy. Oh.
I'm not saying you're wrong. I don't know. I don't think it'd be Thor either, because Thor's... I always feel like Thor's kind of one-dimensional of a character.
Yeah, he is. He's just like... Have you... Okay, so I watched...
He's a fish out of water.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's just a fish out of water story for him in the first one, at least. But yeah. Freaking the first... Okay, I might go off on a little tangent here, but that's I watched fine. Thor the Dark World.
I did, and, too. All right.
Yeah, so it was weird. Like, it was just whatever. Anyway, the first Thor, I made fun of it the whole way through, and like, you know, every time I make fun of it, I like bring up the Frost Giants line that he just like says at the beginning of the movie because it's just whatever. Mm-hmm. I thought it was funny that the way the narrator said it. So as this movie's starting out, I like, you know, I do the Frost Giants thing to Michelle because, you know, I just do that all the time randomly.
This time it was the Dark Elves.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so the movie starts out and I was like, I wonder how they're going to, you know, what kind of ridiculous thing that they're going to, like, you know, start out with. And the first line in the movie is, "Before there was light, there was darkness. And out of the darkness came the Dark Elves." And I just started busting up laughing, and nobody else knew what I was laughing about.
Well, the issue with Thor's character is he is the Norse god. So he is like 1200s mindset, yeah. Norse. That's where his brain is. So every time he comes to Earth or whatever, he's just like, "Back in Asgard, things are different. Oh, well, you mortals.
I get a carriage." It's funny because a carriage is a car, and he doesn't know the difference.
With Thor, though, he's not actually a god. He's just an alien. Keep that in mind. He's just an alien. They live super long lives, and even though people think he's a god just because he's an alien, and how Asgard is their culture, and they brought that to Earth or whatever, and that's how he thinks it is, and when he sees that it's changed, he doesn't understand because Asgard culture hasn't changed in, like, those thousands of years.
Yeah, it's weird because he looks exactly like people. It's like Superman, so it's like, you know. Superman kind of sucks.
Superman's horrible.
Thor...
We've talked about this.
Thor sucks for some of reasons, but he's not as bad because he's just not invincible all around.
Thor's still got some cool stuff going for him. I like his old classic outfit with, like, the big discs on his chest and the wings on his helmet. He's
except
a pretty cool guy.
Have that movie.
Yeah.
You know who's way better than Thor, though? You know who's way better than Thor?
Don't say Loki.
I'm not saying Loki. Beta Ray Bill.
Yeah! Wait, what was that?
Beta Ray Bill's. Beta Ray Bill.
Who's that?
You don't know who Beta Ray Bill is? Oh, he's a character in the comics who's another alien, but he's got like a big horse face. and there's like, when he was introduced, there's one comic series where Thor lost his hammer and everyone thought Thor was dead. And Beta Ray Bill's the only guy in the universe who was worthy enough to pick up the hammer. And he started being Thor. And he was so much of a bro that Odin adopted him and made him his own hammer, and now he dresses like Thor and he like protects the universe like Thor does. Thor's adopted brother.
I've seen Beta Thor before, but I never like knew his backstory, and I was always really confused. That makes way more sense now.
He's the biggest dude, awesome guy in the Marvel universe, pretty much. So because he's the only. Face? He's pretty much got a horse face here. I'll find a picture of him and get to you.
Okay.
So slightly get us back on. Go up, huh?
Back on track.
Back on track. We're picking a favorite Avenger for Hayden.
Yeah. Go ahead and send the picture while we're talking.
Once again, I.
Oh, but one more thing, though.
Yeah.
One more thing, though. You said Superman's not a good character, and I would say, eh, you're kind of right, but if you want a really good Superman story where Superman's cool, read Red Sun.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's a different
Red Superman. Sun. Red Sun's. No, it's pretty much the same Superman.
Wait, what are you talking about? Red Sun. Does that mean like he doesn't have his powers anymore?
No, it's super. It's basically a what if story, and it's what if Superman, instead of landing in Kansas, landed in the Soviet Union during the Cold War.
So he fights for Russia instead of American justice. But there's
And how they explain like the Green Lanterns and Batman and all those people like in that universe is way cooler than the normal.
So are they in Soviet Russia as well, or are they in America?
The Green Lantern's an American character, Wonder Woman's an Amazonian, and Batman's a character who instead of his parents being killed by some random guy in the alley, his parents were killed by like Stalin's death troopers, and he was raised in an internment camp, and that's why he hates the state.
Oh, wow.
So he's basically a terrorist. But yeah, that's bad rip.
I think there's also a Red Sun Wonder Woman and Red Sun Batman series.
No, there's. I don't think
there is. Are there not?
There's not. They're in. They are in Red Sun. They do. Okay. And they do have the costumes, but they don't have their own series.
Okay, I was gonna say I've seen them on like covers. So okay. Anyway, Avengers, which is way cooler. I also don't think Hayden's favorite character would be Captain America because he's also kind of bland. I mean,
No, man. Captain America's the best.
He's got...
Captain America's the most American.
Yeah, he's the most American. He does have a cool backstory, but I think there's better people on the Avengers.
I gotta say, in the Avengers, he's kind of bland, because, you know... Yeah. But in the Captain America movie by itself was freaking awesome. Like,
are we talking about movie Avengers, or are we talking overall?
I think we're talking about Avengers. Well, I don't know.
I know Phil and I are probably more versed in movie Avengers than actual Avengers.
Yeah.
I've read some probably more versed in actual Avengers.
I know of Ant-Man and, like,
what's her name?
The Wasp Lady. But, I mean, I can't tell you anything about them that's, like, like, Black Panther and then that I'm, like, you know. So...
You know, if this podcast could go, like, 3 or 4 hours, I would go on a huge tangent about Ant-Man.
And it can go as...
What they're doing... Well, I got some things I want to talk about, but I don't know if we can do it for this podcast. Okay. Like we can. Well, do you want to keep doing questions, or do you want me to go on a tangent and maybe come back to the questions?
Okay, well, let me see. We can get the questions out of the way, and then there's the discussion part afterwards.
Let's get the questions.
Okay, questions out of the way. I'm picking
Truman. Jesus.
I'm picking Iron
questions,
Man.
Questions. We got to get back to the questions. Okay,
Man is Hayden's favorite Avenger.
I think it's Hulk.
Hulk is also really cool. He's probably my favorite.
Okay.
Phil is right. It is the Hulk.
Hulk has a really cool...
I remember, dude. See, yeah, like, I was... Okay.
Because...
Sorry.
Bruce Banner and the Hulk's relationship is way more interesting to me than anything else the rest of Avengers have going for him.
You don't like alcoholism and Iron Man?
Iron Man?
Well, my main problem with Iron Man
Iron Man 3. Sorry.
My main problem with Iron Man is that the movies have made him basically Robert Downey Jr.
Oh yeah.
But comic Iron Man is not supposed to be a likable character at all. You're not supposed to like him at all. He's just a guy in a suit. And then, but the movies, everyone's like, "Oh man, Iron Man's so cool. He's the best Avenger." When really, he's in the comics, he's nowhere near the best.
Yeah.
The dick. Sorry.
Yeah, let's move on.
Okay, Phil, you got the next question. No, I do.
You got the next question.
What is Hayden's favorite holiday?
Oh, his holiday. His favorite holiday has always been Christmas, and it always will be. Christmas is the best time of the year, and he has to agree with me. Is that correct, Hayden?
Christmas is the best time of the year aside from Halloween.
Boom. Oh, I didn't know that you liked Halloween.
You pulled a nightmare like Christmas on you.
I like, yeah, all did. I like all the spooky, scary skeletons. Some would even say that they're too spooky.
He did pick Nightmare Before Christmas, Truman. That's exactly what he did.
It's a pretty good movie. Horrible fan base. It's
the best Thanksgiving movie there is.
What? What are you laughing at, Phil?
Nothing. Best Thanksgiving movie there is?
The best Thanksgiving movie there is.
Yep. Best Thanksgiving movie there is Thanksgiving. It's a horror movie.
I think you're getting that.
Is that the one with
I think you're getting that confused with Peter Cottontail, Truman.
Is Thanksgiving the one with the turkeys?
I think so.
They kill all the people they attack. Like the zombie turkeys or whatever it is.
I just remember this, like,
it's whatever that movie is, that's right.
A homicidal turkey axes off college kids during Thanksgiving break.
Yeah, I want to see that. You mind if we just, like, see that next time we hang out? You just bring that over and we'll just watch it for Valentine's Day. Celebrate Valentine's Day. Watching that.
The most romantic movie of all, a movie about Thanksgiving.
I gotta say, that would be the most romantic for me. Favorite Mario power-up, Truman? Do you think Hayden's is?
I always do weird stuff whenever I'm thinking. I'm gonna go with Boot from Mario 3. The little shoe you jump in. You walk across spikes. That joke last time.
We're gonna need some new questions. Our answers are stale.
Well, good thing that we're gonna take a break from Guestman after Hayden. We'll write some good ones.
That's fine. Anyway,
Hayden, what's your favorite Mario power up?
Not that shoe. Just gonna say that right now.
Yeah.
I don't know if it counts as a power up if it's a game mechanic, but does Flood count as a power up?
You know, I don't think that doesn't count.
Do you have a favorite nozzle? Because those are power-ups.
I'll say the nozzles. Flood's, not the jetpack one, but the one that shoots you super up high is like super.
Yeah.
His rocket one, rocket. Yeah. The rocket nozzle. Yeah.
Okay.
I like
I'll count that.
Because that's the only way you can beat Bowser with the rocket nozzle.
Yeah.
I like the speedy one. That one's my favorite.
Is that the one where you get on your stomach and you're like a penguin and you just...
No, that's you just like run and shoot water and then dive and you slide in water.
It's just a regular nozzle that you shoot behind yourself, basically.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's like all the power of the rocket nozzle only pushing you forward instead of up. I love speed rocket. It's the best. All right, so Phil, what is Hayden's... who does he main... on Super Smash Bros.
Melee, I believe that he played as Bowser and Mewtwo most often. Possibly Ganondorf. I don't think so. I think he mostly played as Bowser and Mewtwo. Brawl, I don't know, but probably Bowser. Maybe King Dedede. Because, as he said earlier, he normally plays as the heavyweight characters just because they're just unstoppable. Freaking... all rough and tough and buff and gruff and stuff. Yep. So I'm just going to say Bowser right now, probably. Maybe Mewtwo late, like earlier when he was still around. Maybe Mewtwo will come back now since he's in Pokemon Y and X. And, you know, but right now Bowser. Is that correct, Hayden?
Bowser for Melee, yes. King Dedede for Brawl.
You like that big gay dance? Is that it?
The big penguin, yeah.
The big gay dance when you get the Smash Bro. Smash Bro, the Smash Ball.
Yeah, and then the Waddle Doos and Waddle Dees and Waddle Tums and Waddle De crap. Rain down.
But I'd also like to say that I do have another love who I in both games who I switch off if I'm not playing Bowser, if I'm not playing a heavy character, and that's the Captain Falcon.
Oh, yeah, because he's the best.
Yeah! The Captain Falcon.
I mean, it's not as good as Peach, but it's pretty good.
As good as Peach.
I keep forgetting that my sister and her boyfriend is in the other room.
Gross!
So you just yell.
Dicks!
But nah, I play Peach a lot because it infuriates people. Because I just hip-check everybody.
Remember? Oh yeah, at Tokyo and Tulsa, I swear, I was telling Truman about this earlier, every single year at Tokyo and Tulsa that me and Truman have gone, I've seen you, Hayden, one time and one time only. Every year. And, yeah, but anyway, this last time that we went, he played as Peach and I played as Jigglypuff, and we just sat there and taunted the whole time while guys are trying to play seriously around us, and it's pretty funny.
Collusion. Speaking of Tokyo and Tulsa, like, going off on a small tangent, I think I did see you this year.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
It was very, very brief. I was like, hey, man, what's going on?
Who are you? I don't remember that. I think I saw you, like, from afar. I was like, is that Phil over there? I'm not sure. I remember someone saying, hey, man, to me.
I swear, maybe. We just exchanged, like, a couple words, and I had to go somewhere while you had to go somewhere else, and that was it.
That was 2012. I'm talking about this year.
I swear, I know I saw you last year, too, though. Or this year, whatever. It's last year now, since it's
2013. Let's just say 2013.
Okay.
But anyway, yeah, but I don't remember. I remember, I think I saw you. Were you with someone in a cosplay?
Me.
Who are you cosplaying as?
Porco Rosso.
Okay, then I did see you.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I was like, yo, there's Porco Rosso. Is that Phil next? Porco Rosso, and I was like, yeah, it looks like Phil. I don't know. I have to get to a panel because I gotta make fun of people.
I swear we exchanged like a couple words, but we were both in like a hurry to get somewhere else. Whatever.
Speaking of Porco Rosso, do you like my costume, Hayden?
It was pretty cool. Yeah.
Good.
If I knew that was you, I would have taken the time to say, give me a picture, and oh, hey, Phil.
Yeah.
I'm still trying to figure out who I'm going for this year.
Yeah, I kind of want to go as Rayman, but I don't think I have the hair for it.
Man, that'd take a lot of work to get the costume together.
You don't have the hair for it, and you also have an excess of limbs.
Well, we discussed how to get away with that. For a while, we were talking about him being Rayman, and I'm Globox.
Oh, black.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I thought you were going to say you're going to put plastic wrap over your arms to make it look like you're queer, but...
Yeah, that's a great idea.
I'll just wrap yours around my arms.
Oh, yeah, just take a clear...
Just take some Glad wrap and just say, no, you can see my arms under it, but... Because whenever someone says, I'm gonna cosplay a character with no limbs, I think, so you're just gonna make something that looks like it's clear, even if it's not.
It just painted clear.
Because I never
painted invisible.
I never understood like the full black suits that people use, because unless you're like in a stage performance where there's hardly any light where you can get away with trying to be all black, I don't see the point of it, because you're standing yourself out more than your cosplay is.
Yeah. Well,
like that dude. Like that dude who was Navi at Tokyo and Tulsa had the Navi on a stick, and he was in a full black suit, and he just had the Navi on a stick.
And everything was white walls and light gray floor.
Yeah. Well, it's probably because it's theater style costuming. And black
it's
is just like
traditionally accepted. Known as, yeah.
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 If it's just a solid black, then it's supposed to be. It's supposed to not be there.
Yep. Even though it's clearly there, because it contrasts with everything around him.
Mm-hmm. Hey, Phil.
What's up?
Got one more question for me?
Yeah. What do you think Hayden's favorite kind of ice cream is?
Rocky Road.
Rocky Road? Jesus. That's disgusting. Why do you pick that every time?
No, I'm going cookies and cream.
Yeah, that's a good type. Rocky Road is delicious. Like the Brussels
Ruffles. I like Barkey Road.
It's like the Ruffles sprouts.
It's chocolate ice cream with marshmallows and nuts in it. How is that bad? It's good.
Brussels are the Ruffles sprouts of Rocky Road.
Ruffles.
Ruffles sprouts. So what do you think, Hayden? Is broccoli road? Sorry, I got vegetables on the mind there. Rocky Road your favorite ice cream or cookies and cream? Or is it something completely different?
Cookies and cream is my second favorite ice cream. I don't like Rocky Road because I don't like nuts, but it would be close to cookies and cream. It would be cookie dough.
This is the best kind.
Well, I used to love cookie dough ice cream, but I ate it like...
Until you ate too much of it.
I ate so much of it as a kid that it kind of... I'm turned off by it. I don't like it anymore.
Yeah, you said last time that it's like ice cream curse. Chunks of egg and salt that turns you off to it.
Delicious.
Yeah, no, it's freaking great. It's like breakfast in a cup.
What are you talking about?
Frozen breakfast. Because it's salted eggs and milk and some other stuff and dough, you know, all the, you know.
This ain't gelato, Phil. This is ice cream.
Gelato? I don't know what gelato
is. Gelato is an Italian style of ice cream like dessert, but it has eggs and milk in it.
That's disgusting.
It's pretty good.
As they say in Scott Pilgrim, milk and eggs, bitch.
Man. It's freaking great. What?
Bacon isn't vegan?
I was going to say, Hayden, you wanted to go off on a little tangent, and since we're done with questions.
I want to go off on like 17 tangents.
We'll pick the best one.
And then we'll do the intermission, and then you can pick the rest.
I forgot what my original tangent was going to be.
You were talking about something superheroes.
About... Oh, yeah, Avengers. Yeah. Oh, Truman. Yeah, the Avengers.
Yeah! True. Hurry up. Then we'll do the
intermission. Are you guys going to say something? Or?
Oh, well, I was just saying that Truman's like, yeah, pick the best one. He sounds like so uninterested.
I'm interested. I just don't want to have... A 4-hour podcast.
Oh, shut up, Truman. Shut up.
Okay, I can edit a four-hour podcast, Phil. It's me.
Yeah, well, you know, you don't have to edit it. You could just leave it in as it is because, you know, it's the best original information that you're ever going to get. You need to switch around the words and make them sound better to your liking.
I don't do that. For the most part, I just export it as a WAV file.
I know, and you're like, oh, I gotta edit it all.
Well, I mean,
in reality, you listen through it all the way through, and you're like, yeah, that's pretty good.
I pick out any bugs, chop it down a little bit, I put music in.
That's it.
Fade in, fade out. And then...
Okay, yeah, yep.
That's hard work.
I'm sure it is.
And then I make a title card, and then I put it in my video program.
Oh, those title cards, man, they suck.
And then
even though you
have
got
to render it.
And have the image in your document.
And have to upload it.
Yeah, I'm sure, yeah. It's a lot of...
Sounds like hard work.
Yeah, it sounds like about like 15 minutes of hard, normal work.
Plus the time it takes to listen to the podcast. So.
I have to listen to the podcast like 4 times before I'm done.
And then you ask me to listen to it through on YouTube just to make sure it's, you know...
Well, I mean, at that point, I'm not going to do it all again.
I know, but you still say, is it
good? I listen to the podcast every time.
Every day.
And
because he's the only true fan that we have. Everybody else is just ourselves.
You guys just make your own account. You guys make alternate YouTube accounts and say, yeah, this is a great podcast.
Yeah, that's right. I did it once.
Totally not Phil 1157 says.
This is great.
Worst podcast ever. 10 out of 10.
Chatmen shared something on Facebook. Look like 2 other people shared it.
Yeah. Who can they be? Oh, that's...
Oh, it has 2 likes on it. I wonder who liked it.
Actually, I had 3 likes. It says Phil, Truman, and the Chatmen, which is Phil and Truman.
So we have 4 likes.
4 altogether, yeah. Me, you, and me and you. Which is...
Well, yep. You know what they say. If you can't like yourself, you can't like anyone else. So,
and nobody else could like you either. You're just pretty much all alone.
Worst podcast ever. 10 out of 10.
Yep. 0 out of 10. Now, if you,
no,
if
let's be too.
You could make our podcast even better than it already's not by going ahead and tell us about that tangent you were talking about.
Good segue,
giving us
Phil.
Some non-tent that we could thrive off of.
The best non-tent. Okay. There's two I want to talk about, but I'll talk about this first one because it's more recent.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, have either of you played the Deadpool video game?
Yes, all the way through.
I just downloaded it on Steam.
You just now got it on Steam like 2 days ago, right? When it was on sale, right?
Yeah, I bought it day of.
Because here's what I want to talk about. Because I bought it like 2 days ago because I heard it was terrible, and I wanted to play it just because to see how bad it is. Because people are saying it's mediocre at least.
Yeah.
And here's the thing I want to talk about. Apparently, Activision's contract with to the rights to Deadpool ran out yesterday, and it has been pulled from Steam, and they are pulling it from stores because they have no longer have the right to sell it.
Oh, I heard about some game getting pulled. I didn't know it was Deadpool.
Oh yeah, apparently it was supposed to be like on the community choice sale like sometime the other day on Steam, like yesterday, and it got replaced with Call of Duty because they pulled it right as it went on that choice.
That makes sense, because I was trying to vote for it and it wouldn't load my vote.
Wow.
Oh, but yeah, apparently it didn't do as good as they want on sales that Marvel didn't even consider updating their contract to let them sell it. So now it ran out 6 months or however far we are away from when it originally came out. So,
jeez, that really sucks.
Well, I enjoyed the game. Just saying.
Did you play it yet, Hayden?
I have not, mainly because I don't like Daniel Way's interpretation of Deadpool, mm-hmm. and the game was written by Daniel Way.
Yeah.
What is his interpretation of Deadpool?
It's the new Deadpool.
Lol so random chimichanga Deadpool. And I saw enough videos on YouTube that I was like, I don't like this Deadpool. Because apparently there's a scene where he's talking to Cable, and Cable's face just turns into a taco for no reason.
That sounds familiar.
And I don't...
Yeah.
It sounds terrible, to be honest.
So actually that's like the only way that I know Deadpool.
Mm-hmm.
So what was he like before that then?
Okay, Deadpool, you know how Deadpool's funny, he's sarcastic, mm-hmm. he's all that. How Daniel Way writes him, it's a lol so random, I'm doing this because I'm random. The actual classic Deadpool is, he does that because he's emotionally scarred, and he's really like super depressed, but he puts on a smiley face and makes everyone laugh because
there's definitely none of that in the game at all.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because a lot of the older stories were good because Deadpool would talk, would like make his crack his jokes, but then there'd be some reason like why he's not just a also random dumb character, but he has some emotional reason to be doing what he's doing.
There was
I was gonna say there was
a newer story that was, I was reading like the new ones right after each other, and it caught me slightly differently because it wasn't just like, let's be cool and be Deadpool. He had this like moment of talking about dying and trying to kill himself in the ocean. Do you remember that one?
Oh, with the shark that was talking to him, the dead shark that he killed. Yeah,
that's like my favorite story of the new run because it actually talked about.
Well, when was this? Was this earlier this year,
I've got the volume right behind me. I can just like reach into the shelf and pull it out.
Because they changed writers like late last year. It's no longer Daniel Way.
It's fairly recent, but it's like probably 2 years old, maybe.
That's still being the run. But there was a lot of stories that they did where Daniel Way wasn't writing it, mm-hmm. but they were like one-offs. But the main series Daniel Way wrote, and then apparently that Deadpool rubs me the wrong way.
I know.
Because I remember him being a serious as Deadpool can be character, but then Daniel Way just made him, let's make everything chimichangas and Cable's
does
got
it
a
really,
taco.
Does it really ruffle your feathers?
really, it rustles my jimmies. It rustles
name
my
of,
jimmies.
Name of the episode, Ruffles.
Okay.
Mark the that chips. Down.
Ruffles the chips.
Ruffles the chips.
That really ruffles my chips.
Yeah. Here, oh, man.
I want to, I know you guys haven't played very much of the game. I've played it all the way through. And,
yeah.
And I'm going to tell you what I think about the game. Without okay. spoiling please, story or anything.
You can please you do. Can spoil whatever you want
okay.
to me. I don't
well,
know
yeah, I don't.
I think
no,
the
you
game...
can spoil what you want. I don't care about the game.
Okay.
I've already yeah. told you, I don't care about it. I bought it because I want to at least experience it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go on, Truman.
I went into the game with the mindset of the chimichanga random Deadpool. So yeah. I was expecting those jokes. What?
And you got what you paid for, Ice.
Yeah, I enjoyed the humor in the game. I think the gameplay was kind of stale. Their idea of making the game harder is just three times as many enemies on the screen. There was no more... You didn't have to figure anything out.
Yeah.
The final boss was kind of a letdown. I say kind of. It was very a letdown.
It was very a letdown.
But there were some good moments. There's a time where... Because, you know, there's three personalities of Deadpool. There's him... Crazy yeah, brain, sane brain, and,
Right, isn't the crazy brain the one that is the chimichangas and the random one?
I would say so, yeah. probably. But it's also
but,
actually...
Okay, so how is that one different in the original? Like, I mean, it probably just doesn't say random stuff. What does it say instead?
It's pretty much the same, just Daniel Way made it more where Deadpool would agree with that brain more.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I gotcha.
In the old series, Deadpool would have these two voices in his head, the kind of serious one and the crazy one, and he'd make up his own mind based on it. In the new ones, the crazy one says something, goes, "You're right, crazy brain," and then goes crazy. And like, there's
yeah,
it,
okay.
what it is there's hardly any difference between Deadpool and the crazy brain.
Yeah.
Is the problem.
Okay, when, that makes
the original
a lot of
series.
Sense.
He was. It was more. Now it's more. He's one character with a sane brain that he never listens to, in the originals, and I guess the current one that's not written by Daniel Way, because I heard that they've tried to go steer clear away from that Lulsa random.
Yeah.
That it's now it's, what it should be is he's got a sane brain, he's got a crazy brain, and then he's Deadpool, and these brains just mm-hmm. commentate. They have no impact. They just commentate.
Yeah.
Okay.
Instead of him. Siding with one or the other.
Okay. Yeah.
But in the game, there's a period, there's a section where essentially there's like three trials, and it's doing like his crazy side of the brain is leading one, his sane side, and then him. And two of the, I don't remember which mission actually lined up with which side, but there's one of them was really nice. I enjoyed it. It was an on-rails shooter section, but mm-hmm. I found it very interesting how they portrayed him being crazy. It's probably
you sound
it was his
like,
crazy brain.
You sound like you're trying to avoid spoilers, it sounds like.
Well, it's been...
Well, someone listening to the podcast might not want... Well, then again, they probably can't get the game now. So.
Here's my issue.
Yeah.
I bought the game...
There you go.
I bought the game day one, beat it in a weekend, and I haven't touched it since. So I'm also kind of fuzzy on exactly what happens.
Oh, okay.
For like this section I'm trying to talk about, I remember it being really cool, but I don't know exactly what happened. I remember there were clowns. I remember that happened.
Jesus.
Overall, probably give that game a low C. Like a C minus. It was a decent game.
What out of 10?
A C minus out of 10, Phil.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I don't know, 6.5.
About a 7 out of 10 is what I'd take.
6.5, 7. I don't think I don't like buying games brand new anyway. So, but I still don't feel like I wasted money on it because I did enjoy the game. There were a couple of fourth wall break moments that really caught me off guard and made me laugh, and I enjoy those a lot. So I don't know.
I think I like Deadpool in every single... Actually, I haven't seen the old Deadpool, so now I'm excited about that. Like, the way that you described him, like, not siding with the crazy brain as much.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of like, well, you know, in between, you know what I mean?
Keep in mind, he does side with it occasionally, but he also sides with his sane brain as much,
okay,
too.
Okay, yeah. Okay, that makes sense.
He's not, but it's not randomly pulling out a chimichanga and saying chimichangas or wearing a sombrero. It's more he's just mouthing off is what it is.
Yeah.
He's called the Merkin with the mouth.
Okay. Except in X-Men 3, where they sew his mouth shut.
That's Wolverine.
Is the Wolverine better?
The Wolverine is way better. I was about to ask, have either of you seen The Wolverine?
No, I want to see it. It sounded so good.
It's on my rent list. I've heard that a lot of people don't enjoy it because they're like, why am I paying to see another Wolverine origin story? But I haven't seen
it. It's not a Wolverine origin story. It takes place after X3, and it's a bridge between X3 and Days of Future Past, which is coming out.
I'm just voicing what I've read online and the people I talk to who are renting it or choosing not to rent it.
So does it have anything to do with the other X-Men, or is it just Wolverine alone?
It's Wolverine alone, but it's, like I said, it takes place after X3.
Mm-hmm.
Does it refer to any events that happened then, or is it just kind of...
It refers to the fact that Jean Grey dead, is what it refers to.
Is Jean Grey Wolverine's girl in the movie verse? She is. Okay.
Actually, everything else, she's married to Cyclops, mm-hmm. and then even then they have like flings with people, and it's really drama. It's a good movie, and just for the record, it makes X-Men Origins Wolverine non-canon. Like, it didn't even happen.
Wow. So,
that's a good...
That's pretty cool.
Because they knew that was such a horrible mess, that they're like, yeah, write this so that it doesn't... So that when things, like, are referred to, it, like, gets rid of those and say, no, that's not what happened, this happened
mm-hmm.
instead.
Oh,
and
yeah.
But it leaves that area of history where it should be moderately gray, so you don't know what happened, but there's enough to see that it didn't happen.
Well, here's the serious question about the new Wolverine movie. Does it have Will.i.am in it? Because if it doesn't, I'm not going to watch it.
Who's Will.i.am?
I don't think it does. I'm sorry.
He was in X-Men Origins Wolverine. He was one of the, what are they called? I've gone brain dead. The Weapon X original group.
Yeah.
Will.i.am is one of the Black Eyed Peas singers who also quote unquote acts.
Oh, okay.
But he is in that movie.
He's not in the Wolverine because there's hardly any references to him being Weapon X, except for the fact that he has adamantium claws and a healing factor. The rest of it's basically the Wolverine run that they did a long time ago, where he was in Japan. They're just retelling that, but they're compensating to the fact that this is a movie verse where stuff different from the comics has happened and all that.
Yeah.
So they're trying to tell the story of what happened when he was in Japan, and they changed some stuff, but it fits for the movie verse.
Okay.
If I was gonna rank them, I'd say the Wolverine's the best one. No, wait, First Class is the best one, then Wolverine, then X2, and then everything else.
Yeah, I heard one and three are kind of weird, not as good as the two one, for some reason.
Yeah, because one is all right. It's a good, this is the X-Men kind of introducing them movie. Three is pretty abysmal, but not as bad as Origins, and Origins is so bad it's not canon anymore.
All right. So, okay, during the break, the intermission or whatever, I'm going to look for that comic that I guess Daniel Way wrote, maybe, and read the serious bit that Truman was referring to and see what you think about it, Hayden.
And also...
Well, let me say something real quick before we go to intermission. It's not that I don't like Daniel Way. I think he's an all right writer. He can write Deadpool nice and kind of funny. It's just that I don't really like his Deadpool.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
Also on the break, I have a video I want you guys to watch, and we're going to discuss things after the break.
All right, cool.
We'll go into more tangents, because I have another one if you want it, or we can talk about.
All right, well, we'll see if we have time.
See you in a bit, guys. Hey, Phil.
Whoa. Forgot. Had to put in the earbuds. The good old earbuds so I could hear what you guys are saying.
Oh, yeah?
Yep. I got the volume. It's volume
I don't three. Think Hayden's with us yet.
Oh, shit.
I'm right here.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Wow.
Cool.
Hello.
Waiting for you to go on.
Yeah, this is,
Hi.
This is volume 3, chapter... Hold up. 15, I guess? Yeah, chapter 15 of Deadpool, written by Daniel Way, and he, like, hold on, let me try to sum this up, because it's, like, 5 pages or something. He's, like, on a boat, and he's
talking. He's playing pirate.
Yeah.
He bought a boat.
Yeah, that's right, he was playing pirate. Yeah, he was pretending to be pirates, because he's, crazy, and he was having a hallucination or whatever. But anyway, it goes back to normal, and shows him by itself, and his same brain's like, why do we do this? And then the insane brain's like, do what? And he says, this, hurt ourselves, and he's sticking a knife in his leg. And the crazy one's like, it doesn't hurt that much. And then the sane one's like, sure it does. He says, okay, yeah, it does kind of hurt, but at least it's exciting. He's like, there are other ways to avoid boredom. We could get a hobby. And the insane is, we shoot people. That's not a hobby. Well, how about fishing? What are we fishing for? For what we need. For what we need or for what we... Or for what we need or for what we want. Same thing. No, it isn't. Not to us. Getting what we need would be easy. You know, it's... And then, you know, Deadpool finally talks. It's not his brain anymore. He says, you know, it's really boring. Immortality. And he jumps into the water filled with sharks. He's just in there with a bunch of sharks. He's like, here we... The same brain's like, here we go again. How many times have we put ourselves in ridiculously dangerous situations, most of which we ourselves create, for little to no reason all and for little to no real gain? Is that what we really want? And he's just there, and the sharks are surrounding him and stuff.
Because he's bleeding, isn't he?
Yeah, he is bleeding. He just stabbed himself in the leg. And he says, maybe we just like the attention. Maybe, without a doubt, we like the attention, but from whom? From whoever. And he says, and then the same one's like, whomever, huh? Oh, from whomever is paying attention, and there it is, and there's a shark. There, what is? From whomever is paying. Kind of tragic that we're probably the only mercenary in the world who'd be happy to be paid in attention rather than cash, isn't it? That is kind of tragic. Yeah, but not as tragic as to what we do to those that actually give us the attention. And he puts some sort of underwater gun up to the shark and blows it up. Blows it to pieces, and then he brings the shark aboard, talks some more, you know, and then there's a Death, like a skeleton in a cloak at a table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's Death. She showed up a lot.
Yeah, Death.
Yeah.
She's in love with Deadpool.
Yeah, she shows up in the game, by the way.
Except this is a hallucination, another hallucination or whatever. He's talking to her, and they're having a conversation, and he's like, he says something like, oh, you're not real, are you? And she says, no, Wade, not to you. Disappears. Case in point is what the sane brain says. And they're like, so what's the plan? Don't know, maybe I'll just lay here and let the sun cook my flesh into jerky, then watch helplessly as the seagulls pick me apart and carry my pieces to strange new lands. And, you know, the shark, the dead shark that's next to him that's blown to pieces, says, wow, that's original. And then Deadpool asks, what the hell do you mean by that? I mean, that's my plan. Get your own. That's what the shark says. And Deadpool's like, I'm unoriginal. Are you serious? Everything I do is original. Everything I am is original. There's nobody like me. And the shark says, do you realize what you're saying, don't you? Or you do realize what you're saying, don't you? And Deadpool's like, yeah, I'm the shit, man. No, what you are is alone. That's what the shark says to Deadpool. And then there's just the sea that Deadpool's looking out into. And then Deadpool starts thinking about all the friends that he have. He says, that's not true. I have friends. There's Weasel. It shows him holding a knife to Weasel. And Blind Al. And shows some blind guy. Yeah. And
those,
what's his face?
Those characters are way funny.
Yeah, those and then and, funny. And what's his face? And there's the parrot that he was playing pirate with. And he's about to hit it with a plunger. Guess that makes us friends too. After all, I gave you what you needed when you needed it, is what the dying, the dead, decomposing shark says to Deadpool. And then Deadpool's like, look, pal, I don't like being judged. And the shark says, I know you don't. I think it is actually the only thing that you're afraid of. And then Deadpool says, I'm not afraid of that. I'm not afraid of anything. It's just, look, I'm ugly. I'm weird in my brain. I think it's like deformed or something. And his brain says, hey, we got your deformation right here, buddy. And then and he says, I'm cool with that. I accept that. It's not my problem that nobody else can accept it. And then the shark says, actually, that is your problem. How can you expect anyone to accept you for what you really are when you never show them who you really are? And then Deadpool says, hey, it's not like I'm the only guy running around in a mask. Bingo, we have a winner. That's it. That's the moment. It's the moment of seriousness.
Surrounded by, like, couple chapters earlier, he makes like 5,000 pancakes, and then doesn't he also like cut his leg off and use the plunger like a peg leg later?
Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
So in all that little random Deadpool, that little moment just jumps out.
Yeah.
It was a little more sincere than
the rest of it.
Yeah.
But that was just the part that entered both of our heads.
What was that, Hayden?
Yeah, there is some of that in Daniel Way's writing, I'll admit that. But there's so in the past there were a lot more stories that did have some like jokes in them, but for the most part they were straight serious. Like one where he tried to where he like was like about saving a kid, and he saves a kid, and at the end of it he remembers how his dad was, and he's like doing this monologue. I have the picture somewhere. I can't find it right now, but it. He's like doing this monologue talking about how his dad, how he'd always like his dad would come like open the door with a knock knock joke, and he's remembering it, and like he's like his dad would go knock knock. He goes, who's there? And he goes, I don't remember what it was. It was some dumb joke about him being a walnut or something like that. He said he was like a walnut. He goes, walnut. I knew you were a little nut or something like that. And like he give Deadpool a noogie, and then it ends with him like talking about how one day his dad just didn't show up. And his dad like basically abandoned him, and then it goes on, and this it like transitions to another panel where he knocks on he finally visits this old man. He knocks on the door, and the guy goes, who's out there? And he says, Wade. He goes, what? And the guy goes, Wade who? And he takes off his mask and says, Wade till you get a load of me, Dad. And it's just really depressing scene.
Because
his dad doesn't know that he's been like deformed and all that stuff, so he's saying wait till you get a load of me and like what he looks like now and all that, so it's really depressing. But
no, that sounds
it's
good.
Like more straight serious.
Phil and I
our issue is the only Deadpool we've actually read is like new Deadpool.
Yeah,
and that's fine. True. You can read whatever kind of Deadpool you want.
I actually
but
think
I'm just
that
saying,
one sounds
my issue is sounds what
good. I think that one sounds a lot more interesting, because that moment with the shark thing was like, whoa, like I felt more connected to him in moments like that than I did the other ones. The other ones, it's just like, haha, look what he's doing now. That's pretty funny.
Yeah. And in all of them that I read, because I borrowed like all of them that Phil bought.
Yeah.
That is the only moment that stuck out that like I actually remember.
Yeah, me too. Really, because that's what entered both of our minds specifically. That one scene.
Don't you mean Pacifically, since he was in the ocean?
I don't know. Was he in the Pacific Ocean or the Atlantic Ocean?
I don't know.
The only thing in the Pacific Ocean is a bunch of kaiju.
Oh,
ba-da-dum, ba-da-dum. I found out that there's not one ripoff movie of that. There's actually two ripoff movies of Pacific Rim.
Atlantic Rim.
I know about Atlantic Rim, but what's the other one?
There's another one called Cloverfield. They Came from the Deep. And I was reading it. It's about how sea monsters rose out of the eastern seaboard, and we had to build robots to take them down. And it was released roughly the same time as Atlantic Rim.
There's a show coming out made by the guy who directed the X-Men movies. I forgot what it's going to be called. Oh, man, I got to look that up.
Is it My Little Kaiju? Because I wanted to write that for a while.
Right. That is exactly what it was. Go on with what you were saying.
My Little Kaiju. Friendship is magic. I was saying there's also a ripoff show called Attack on Titan. Ba-dum-bum.
Oh, yeah.
Great. Ba-dum-bum, ba-dum-bum. Don't get me started.
I almost got those two themes mixed up when you were just now.
Phil, I don't know why Attack on Titan's so popular, because there's a better anime that is out and is, like, currently still making episodes.
What is that?
Kill la Kill.
Yeah, that show's good.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
How good is it? What is it about?
Very good. Phil, did you like Gurren Lagann?
I haven't seen it.
Did you watch Gurren Lagann? You need to watch Gurren Lagann. Let's get that out of the way real quick.
Okay.
Have you watched Fooly Cooly?
No.
That's also on my list.
You need to watch Fooly Cooly too. But anyway, it's made by the people who made Gurren Lagann and Fooly Cooly, and those two are both very over the top animes, especially Gurren Lagann. And Kill la Kill is basically, hey, let's make it over the top but put it in a different setting, and it's just as good as the other two. I would recommend watching all three because they're all amazing.
Right, Phil, here.
Creature at Bay. Anime here. Hold on. Creature at Bay is the sci-fi series that is coming out. It's sci-fi. Directed by Bryan Singer, the dude who made sci-fi. X-Men Days of Future Past, the director or something. I don't know. Is that director, and he's going to be making a kaiju film. Kaiju means giant monster, or actually strange beast, but is translated from the Japanese whatever genre to giant monster here. And that is what that means for those of you at home who don't know what we're talking about, who probably haven't been listening this far in. But anyway... he's making a kaiju series soon. I don't know when it's coming out. Let's see. Right.
I probably won't watch it.
Creature at Bay, Okay. If it's on sci-fi, you probably won't watch it. That's fine. But I'm serious.
Okay. I know you enjoy large monsters. But
You like the X-Men.
We all enjoy large
monsters. Hayden, at least you should... Yeah, I know, me too, but I mean, like, are you getting at, Truman? You're saying you don't like?
I don't like giant monsters as much as you like giant monsters, is all I'm saying.
Truman
is
sorry.
Racist against kaiju.
What was that, Hayden?
Truman's racist against kaiju.
Yes, I am.
Yeah, I know, what the heck, man? Just because
Leatherback, that guy's pretty cool.
Yeah, Leatherback is freaking sweet. He's the electric turtle gorilla thing from the movie Pacific Rim. But
I was about to say he's especially racist to Leatherback until he said that.
Yeah, it's like King Kong and Gamera had a baby, and King Kong had electricity in Godzilla versus King Kong.
Bum 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 bum.
I was about to say it gave him electric powers, and I was like, well, King Kong had them so that he could fight Godzilla and also be like a million times his original height.
Alright, Phil, I was gonna tell you about Kill la Kill, because I think if our viewers are listening, they should watch it too. Even if you don't like the theme of the show, how it's presented is really cool to watch. Like, animation's way over the top and awesome, and presentation's really cool.
I just looked up a picture, and I just saw a lady with absolutely no clothing,
except for
suspenders.
You know the trope?
Yeah, here's the thing.
That... in women's armor, like in video games and anime and stuff, like the less clothing, stronger. They're poking fun at that because the two strongest women, they have these suits that let them go super crazy powerful, but they're like super risque, over the top.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the more exposed they are, the more power they get.
So what if they just decided to not wear any armor or clothes at
then
all?
Then they don't have powers because they're not wearing the suit anymore.
Yeah. Oh my god!
It's like a
makes so much sense. So if you just have like a Lord of the Rings ring and nothing else, you're good.
It's they have like a symbiotic relationship with the suit, like the main character.
Like Spider-Man in Spider-Man 3.
Her suit has a conscious
mind. Don't talk about Spider-Man 3. Please,
Spider-Man 3, Sandman is cool. The rest of that movie can go in a hole.
Spider-Man 3 is good up until... It's good up until they got... the emo scene's the best part of that movie.
Okay.
It's good up until they got Topher Grace to be Venom, and he's in the chapel going, "God, please kill Spider-Man." And then the Venom suit comes down, because just the way he delivered that scene ruined the whole movie, and then everything after that was terrible.
Yeah, and then the same people, wasn't it? Yeah, it's still Sony. Just so that they could keep the rights to Spider-Man, they had to like make a new Spider-Man movie, but they didn't want to make Spider-Man 4 after that, so they're like, Amazing Spider-Man. So there will never be a Spider-Man Avengers until Sony lets go of the rights to that.
If they ever make a Fantastic Four 3 or 4 or whatever the count is.
They'll just put Spider-Man Fantastic in. 7. Fantastic 4, Fantastic 5, Fantastic 6.
To be fair, recently in the comics, Spider-Man was a member of the Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
Because Johnny Storm bit it. They made Spider-Man. Like, hey, oh, Spider-Man, you want to be part of the Fantastic Four?
Yeah, and he's like, oh, man, sure, why not? He's my best friend.
Now he's dead.
Isn't...
Yeah.
I'm not up to date on comics, but isn't Doc Ock Spider-Man now or something?
Yes.
Okay.
Let's not talk about that.
Okay. I was flipping through a comic, and I was just really confused, because there's this dream scene where... He pulls the mask off, but it's Doc Ock's face instead of Peter Parker, and I was just like, what the hell is going on?
Yeah, there was a video explaining that on the on YouTube or whatever. It was weird. It was like...
They ended The Amazing Spider-Man.
The way they ended that
was that Peter Parker and Doc Ock, because of Doc Ock's a machine he made, they swapped brains. They swapped consciousness, like their bodies. And then... Peter Parker couldn't, like, in Doc Ock's body, couldn't get reverse it fast enough, so he died. Like, fighting against Doc Ock.
So is Doc Ock, like, a good guy now?
It's explained that it's through Doc Ock's arrogance. He hates Peter Parker so much because Peter Parker's done so much and, like, against him, while Doc Ock has, like, 5 PhDs and, like, is super smart.
Yeah.
But Peter Parker's done more of his life. Doc Ock's like, oh, I'm so angry. I'm going to show you, Peter Parker. I'm going to be the superior Spider-Man.
That makes sense.
So he's trying to be a better Spider-Man than Spider-Man, and what's really happening is he's destroying all of Spider-Man's relationships with people. Like, there's a recent issue where you know, Spider-Man's relationship with Black Cat is she's a criminal, but he's friends with her, and because she is actually a good person, mm-hmm. even though she's a criminal, and Spider-Man lets her go, even though he sometimes says, Black Cat, you shouldn't be a bad person anymore. Spider-Man Ock, who we just call Spock now, Spock, because it's easier just to say Leonard Nimoy
is Spider-Man.
Spider-Man now. Confirmed for The Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Okay. I got you.
But anyway, Spock, in a recent issue, he meets Black Cat, and she thinks it's just a normal Spider-Man, Black Cat, let's talk about things meeting, and he punches her, and then he ties her up in web and calls the police on her.
Oh, shit.
And said, I'm going to do what Spider-Man didn't do. I'm going to send you to jail, Black Cat. And she's like, what is wrong with you, Spider-Man? This isn't how you act. And she gets super mad at him. And it's being implied that that Peter Parker will come back because it's still his mind. It's just Doc Ock's taking control of it. But there's still part of Peter Parker still in the back of the mind somewhere. And what's really making me and a lot of other people mad is that what's going to happen when Peter Parker comes back and has to deal. It's horrifying, really. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Spock.
Thanks, Leonard Nimoy. You ruined Spider-Man.
Okay.
What I'm saying is Spock ruined Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Yeah. Seems like it.
Okay, guys. Well, I sent you a little video. Did you guys watch it?
Oh, yeah. Guardians of the Galaxy.
Guardians of the Galaxy.
Get hyped. Honestly, I haven't heard much about this movie. I feel like it's kind of been under the radar. For me, at least. I was like, I think they're making a movie with Rocket Raccoon.
Oh, man. I knew about it the whole time.
I knew about it, and I've been getting hype ever since.
Well,
the hype meters are off the scales.
There's a pretty high-res pic, so you guys can take a look-see at...
Love Rocket Raccoon.
I saw this earlier today on 4chan, of all places.
Mm-hmm. I saw it on Reddit. That's where I was talking about.
Yeah.
I've heard... Well, first of all, I don't know much about Star-Lord. He looks like a pretty cool character.
Except he's the best character, aside from Rocket Raccoon and Groot.
Well, here's the thing. Chris Pratt, to me, will always be Andy Dwyer on Parks and Rec. So I hope that I won't watch this movie and just think it's Officer Brett... Or what is it? Brett Macklin in space? That's his FBI character that is really stupid.
I have no idea.
I'm sorry to burst your bubble, but that's pretty much what Star-Lord is.
Okay, I'll be fine with that. Phil, to break it down to you, the guy who plays Star-Lord in Guardians, he plays a really dumb guy in an NBC comedy.
Okay, really is Star-Lord the guy with the red and black or whatever?
Fry from Futurama, that's what he looks like.
Okay.
But
I'd say he's a bit smarter than his character in Parks and Rec. But he's still pretty much a space cop. Yeah. Pretty much, that's a non-serious space cop. Is pretty much what he is.
But the Brett Macklin joke, Phil, is his character on Parks and Rec, Andy Dwyer, likes to pretend he's a member of the FBI named Brett Macklin. And it's horribly stupid.
Okay.
So I hope I don't picture that when I watch this movie for real.
Yeah. Are those lines behind them like how many feet tall they are or something?
I have no
clue. Yeah, that's context. I will tell you this. That is a scene. They are in a prison lineup. The movie is going to start with. That's how they meet in the comics. That's how they're going to meet in the movie. Is that they are all in prison right now, or they've been arrested. Because here's the thing about the Guardians of the Galaxy is, you know how the Avengers are the heroes? Mm-hmm. The Avengers are the heroes. They're the guys everyone sees and they cheer for. The Guardians of the Galaxy are, one, the difference between them is, one, they're in space, while the Avengers aren't. And two, they're all like the misfits. These guys shouldn't be villains, but they're not heroes.
Mm. Okay.
And they just kind of band together to be the Guardians of the Galaxy.
And Thanos at the end of the Avengers was like in reference of this movie, right? Because I think he's going to be in this movie.
What I've heard is
I know what it is actually. I know if you want me to break it down.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
Okay. What it's going to be is Thanos at the end of the Avengers 1 was setting up Avengers 3.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And Avengers 2, they're going to do Ultron.
Yeah.
Instead. So okay. Ultron. That's part of my rant about Ant-Man.
Okay. We'll talk about that. Yeah.
We'll talk about that. But first, let's talk about Guardians of the Galaxy because this is a movie that I want way more than this movie. But anyway, the thing about you saw Thor: The Dark World, Phil.
Yes.
And Truman, have you seen it or do you care about spoilers at all about the post-credit scene?
No, I haven't. Are you talking about Thor? Spoiler
Thor: The Dark World.
Thor 2, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't seen either of those. That was my least anticipated movie leading up to Avengers.
So you don't care. You don't care, basically.
Nah.
I know. Giants.
Dark elves.
The dark elves.
But Phil, you saw the post-credit scene, right?
I did. I forgot what it was.
Okay, at the end of Thor 2, they go, Sif and the red-haired guy take the thing that the dark elves were using, that blood cloud thing. They take that to the collector. The collector is a character in the Marvel universe.
Yeah,
and And they say, their line is that he asks them why they're bringing that to him. And he says, well, they say you can keep it safe. And the Tesseract is already in Asgard. We don't need two of these things here. And they give it to him. And he says, and after they leave, he says, one down, five to go. That's in reference to the Infinity Gauntlet, which is what Thanos uses to, because here's another thing is Thanos is literally in love with death. He loves death personification, and he's become immortal. So death has no interest in him because he is immortal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But he loves
death. Like Deadpool. Likes Deadpool.
And death likes Deadpool. It's a big love triangle. But anyway, Death loves Deadpool, but that's not important in these movies.
Yeah.
But he's in love with Death, and he wants Death to notice him, and the only way he thinks that Death will notice him is if he kills everything in the universe till it's only him and Death. So, what the Infinity Gauntlet does, six gems, five on the fingers, one on the middle of the hand of this giant gauntlet. And the Tesseract, the blood thing, and four other gems are what make it up. And when they all come together, they give the wielder the power to do anything they want in the universe, even change natural law and do anything they want with it. And Thanos wants that so he can kill everyone in the universe.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds a lot like the Mandarin, which I think is why they didn't make the Mandarin in Iron Man 3, the Mandarin, as he is in the comics.
The Mandarin has power rings. They're not,
yeah, 10 of
they're
them.
They're not Infinity Gauntlet.
Right, I know. They all do different stuff. But, I mean, it would be very much akin to, like, I keep wanting to call him Thanatos, the Greek god of death or something. But,
that's pretty much where his name comes from.
Yeah, I know.
Thanos.
Whoa! Spoilers! I'm just kidding.
They're basing things off mythology?
Well, when did they ever do that, Thor?
The whole character, Thor.
But anyway,
back to Guardians of the Galaxy. Guardians of the Galaxy is going to kind of expand the whole things are happening in space movie, apparently, is what they're planning on doing with it.
That sounds really cool.
And I think Age of Ultron is supposed to do that too, kind of introduce the Avengers to that kind of stuff more than it did in Avengers 1, where all we saw were aliens attacking. But Guardians of the Galaxy is supposed to expand that kind of to show people more of it and show more of the Collector and what he does and more of everything that's going on in space. So after they defeat Ultron in Avengers 2, it can set up Thanos.
Yeah.
Because Thanos is ultimately the big bad of the Marvel universe.
Aside from
people like Galactus and other things like those guys, Thanos is the one who in the comics has actually killed everyone.
Yeah, he's the Marshall D. Teach of this storyline.
Pretty much Marshall D. Teach. Especially when he gets the Infinity Gauntlet, he's pretty much Marshall D. Teach.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes a lot of sense to me. So, let me see. Is there any explanation to why Rocket Raccoon is a raccoon who can shoot guns?
Okay,
because he's an alien. That's why.
He is really? An alien that happens to look exactly like Earth raccoons.
Stupid! I hate that stuff.
But
I hate that about Superman. I hate that about Thor. Why? Why can't it just be like a normal raccoon that somehow they mutated somehow?
I've heard that maybe in the
bay. Because they're in space, that's why, Phil. When God you go damn. To space, things get weird.
Take a pet raccoon with you to space. Or fucking, like, make a raccoon smart enough to go into space.
Here's what I've heard about this movie, is that they may be presenting Rocket Raccoon not as an alien, but as a science experiment gone wrong from Earth.
Good. I actually like that better. What about Groot, though?
Groot is 100% an alien.
Yeah,
He's from a race of tree people.
He's from Lord of the Rings. He's from Middle Earth.
He's a tree ant. Okay.
Yeah, he's a tree bird's nephew.
Tree bird's nephew, his uncle, and he was the bad kid. So he's a bad seed. Really.
Yeah, he is Groot.
Oh, okay. That was really good. I liked what you did there.
For anyone who didn't get that, it's because they're in a prison lineup. No.
Well, yeah, there's that. Okay, it's also the fact that he's a plant. So
it's also...
So, see, yeah. That
was... All right. I am excited for Guardians of the Galaxy, but I do have a few fears about this movie.
Why?
I'm going to lay them down. Not that the movie itself is going to be bad or anything. I feel like maybe general audiences aren't going to give it the credit it needs. And here's why. Let me break this down for you.
Okay. Avengers. No Robert Downey Jr. Robert Downey Jr. That's what it is. Oh.
That's one of it. But, like, Avengers came out. Everybody loved Avengers. We know there's Avengers 2 coming. How much of the general audience is going to see, oh, it's another team of heroes from Marvel. Aren't they... Why are these guys not the Avengers?
You know what, dude? I think this is so unusual and strange and just, like, different. Like different from the X-Men, the Avengers, or anything else that they've done. That people might... It might pique interest, especially because right in the dead center, there's a fucking raccoon standing in two legs with his arm crossed in a jumpsuit. And a tree to the very right just looking at everybody else like, the heck are you... Well, for those... Sorry.
I feel like the general American audiences, I feel like, may think this... I don't want to say a spoof of the Avengers, but it's got a fuzzy talking animal as one of the lead roles. It's got John C. Reilly in it, which is... He does comedy.
Yeah, there's an comedy. Orc. There's an orc there. There's a tree ant. There's a raccoon. There's Philip J. Fry. And then there's She-Hulk on the very left.
I feel like this movie's going to be really cool, but it may be a gamble for Marvel.
I think it's a good gamble.
Yeah, excited. I think it'll pay out. Fine.
We'll see.
The thing, though, that I don't think that anyone who doesn't read comics, like the general audience you're talking about, that they don't understand is that aside from Thanos and Galactus, and even then they have their moments, everything in space in Marvel is ridiculous. There is hardly anything serious going on in space when it comes to Marvel.
Well, there isn't are the Guardians. I mean,
well, that's pretty much. But anyway, the Guardians of the Galaxy.
In space.
But there's Guardians of the Galaxy. They are serious. They are a serious thing. But the whole point of it is that everything is so outlandish and ridiculous that you have to understand. And I think it might make sense. I think people will see this movie because they already know that Marvel, everything's connected.
Mm-hmm.
So there are going to be people who say, I want to know how this connects to Avengers 2. I want to know how except for things that Sony owns. But those aren't under the Marvel brand. Those are, they Marvel on them, Spider-Man. But they are not under the Marvel brand.
What about Disney? Yeah,
Disney doesn't have Spider-Man. They can't make Spider-Man movies, is what I'm saying. Marvel owns... Really? They don't own X-Men either?
Fox owns X-Men.
Oh, jeez. So Fox owns X-Men. Sony owns Spider-Man.
And I think Sony also owns the Fantastic Four still.
Wow.
Fox. Fox owns the Fantastic Four still. But who Marvel does have is the Punisher.
Marvel also has all of them. It's Disney that doesn't have them. Marvel owns... Oh. But I'm saying that Disney can't make the movies. Isn't that right? Isn't that the thing?
They can make all the movies except for Fantastic Four, X-Men, and Spider-Man.
Right. I'm saying everything else they have
plans out. Yeah. And guess what? Sony and Fox aren't going to give up Spider-Man or the X-Men.
Yeah.
They're too much of a cash cow. They're not going to give them up.
Yeah. I have a.
They have to keep making movies in order to keep them. That's the thing. That's why they keep making movies. So whatever, just go ahead and keep making them until they get stale. Just like Ruffles.
I have a tidbit about Disney, real quick.
Okay.
When Epic Mickey was in production, they wanted to bring Oswald the Rabbit, the character, back to Disney, but. Back in the 40s or something, they traded the rights to Oswald the character to some other company. So in order to get Oswald the Rabbit back for Epic Mickey, they traded a an actual real-life news anchor. They traded him to the other studio in order to get the fake character Oswald the Rabbit back.
What the heck?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They traded his contract for a fictional character. So and they said, you work, and they said, you work for them now.
Yeah.
Go away. Work for them now. And he was like, oh, crap. And just, oh, well, I'll go then. And then he left.
Who is he?
I don't remember.
Some dude.
Was it Oswald the Reporter? I'll trade you my Oswald for your Oswald. My Oswald is a hologram card. A blue-eyes, white Oswald.
I just think that's really cool.
I want to say Warner Brothers. I want to say it was Warner Brothers who owned Oswald. And they had, I think, I want to say it was like somewhere like in Australia, because Warner Brothers, they're the ones who do like the news. Mm-hmm. They own like news companies in Australia. I want to say that Disney traded one of the companies, like one of their ABC reporters. Well, not ABC. Well, could be ABC. Yeah, Australian ABC. Broadcast Central. Yeah. No, I mean, because it's the American broadcast.
Yeah.
So it could be the Australian. But anyway, Australian ABC or whatever, I think they traded one of their reporters down there to whatever Warner Brothers owns in Australia's news down there. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what happened. And they don't care. They wanted Oswald the Rabbit back.
For
and
then that subpar game, video game.
Yeah, for a really subpar video game.
But I just
they were
going to
make that all dark and serious and creepy like the original Mickey Mouse cartoons.
Yeah, they were until Disney was like, whoa, now. This is Disney property. We can't have this. Clean this up.
Clean that right up right now.
Clean this up. We'll make George Lucas write it. And they're like, whoa. Hold on.
George Lucas, don't you remember George R. Binks?
George Lucas took his money and ran after he sold Star Wars.
It was a good move because he fucking made Jar Jar Binks.
Well, I just remember right when they bought Lucasfilms, there's this really horrible picture. They have like the mascot suits of Mickey, Minnie, Goofy, and Donald, and they're all dressed in Star Wars like.
Yeah.
Characters.
I know what you're talking about.
And they've got
about.
Lightsabers, and they've got George Lucas standing with the group, and he looks so sad and just dead on the inside. Oh, it's such a great picture.
It was a real picture?
Yeah.
George Lucas? Yeah,
it was like a press event.
He was like, oh, and he like, God. His face is like, oh, I sold Star Wars. Oh, God. Like, he just looks like the most depressed man.
Send me that picture.
I'm looking for it.
Oh, God.
I don't know. But what I do have, I don't have that. What I do have is leaked footage of George Lucas after he sold Disney. Or after he sold Star Wars.
Oh, this is such a great picture. I love this picture so much.
Oh, man. You just told me. All right. In the description,
yeah.
Truman, in the description of the video, we're gonna show the Guardians of the Galaxy, you know, picture that you sent me. We're gonna show George Lucas.
My goodness, this is sad.
Oh my God. Oh, poor George Lucas.
That poor billionaire.
Darth Vader, Goofy.
With notice, he's got like boxers on too, like Mickey Mouse red and white boxers.
Oh my gosh!
The R2 unit with the Mickey Mouse ears.
He's so sad.
Oh my goodness! I love this picture so much.
There's one picture of that. It's like got like three pictures connected, and it's that one, and it just zooms in on George Lucas's face like for like five more frames. And like they all just and like then there's like the caption. It's like, please kill me.
Oh, my face feels like it's bright red right now. Oh gosh, jeez, that is immensely sad. Oh man.
Well,
I got my ab workout for the day.
I'll say this is a pretty high moment in this episode, and it's like almost an hour 45 minutes.
Oh well.
So
2 hour episode.
Okay.
Ooh, go. I don't know. Unless we got anything else to say?
I mean, probably.
We can go back to talk about Guardians of the Galaxy like we were.
Was there anything left?
I was going to say that I hope it does well.
Yeah.
I really want it to do well because I'm a big Guardians of the Galaxy fan. I really like what's going on in space in Marvel more than I like what's going on, especially in the movies. I want to see what's going on in space. And I was going to say earlier, I think that it'd be easier for people to understand the Guardians of the Galaxy after they've established that Thor is not a god, he is an alien.
Mm-hmm.
So
I still think that's freaking ridiculous.
Thor's an alien, so let's show you that there's more stuff. And we've already seen Loki have an army of aliens. Mm-hmm. Let's show you more aliens. Because in Marvel, and I really wish that Marvel had the rights to the Fantastic Four, because then they could do Galactus. And that would be super sweet if Marvel could do Galactus.
Yeah. That'd be really neat.
Like fighting the Avengers, if Galactus could show up, and Thanos,
too. And Super Skrull.
And the Super Skrull.
Super Skrull. I want to see a Deadpool movie.
Does
Fox own Deadpool? Does Fox own Deadpool?
They own X-Men. Deadpool falls under the X-Men.
Yeah.
Does he really? Why? I can understand. He's a Weapon X.
Deadpool's first appearance was in like X-Force.
Mm-hmm.
So he is technically, even though he has his own standalone series, his standalone series is as much as Wolverine's standalone series. Yeah. He is still under the X-Men moniker.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Disney cannot. Okay, not that I'd want to see a Disney movie of Deadpool.
Wait, of course, guys.
yeah. Then it would be the Chimichangas Deadpool.
Supposedly, there is a Deadpool script floating around Hollywood, USA, somewhere.
And Ryan Reynolds is signed on. He said he will do it.
But a studio doesn't want to commit to a rated R superhero movie because they think it won't do well.
And Ryan Reynolds, I think he would be a great Wade Wilson.
Yeah, they reference him in the comics.
Yeah, they reference him in the comics all the time. He said he will not do a Deadpool movie unless it is rated R. Yeah. He will not do it. He said it has to be, because he's a big fan of Deadpool too,
mm-hmm.
and he likes that they think he would be a good Wade. So what he said he's not going to do a Deadpool movie unless it's a hard rated R.
Yeah.
Not going to do a PG-13.
Let me just ask though, what is specifically rated R that Deadpool is, you know, well, like all about
one.
Okay, yeah, but I mean violence. You could see all sorts of violence in PG-13 movies.
No, here's the thing about Deadpool. His is bloody violence.
Yeah.
You can get an guys, and it's not like the orcs or anything like that. Like Lord of the Rings gets away with. It's to humans. It's to other people. He kills people. He's a mercenary.
Okay,
he murders.
I guess you're right.
Yeah. There's that,
and he gets pretty brutalized too.
Yeah.
He gets his limbs cut off, and he doesn't. And it's not like, oh, I got my limb cut off. He gets his limb cut off, and like blood just squirts everywhere.
And then, like, he'll grab his leg and whip somebody with it, and blood goes everywhere.
In
the comics, like they'd have like curse words all, you know, like ampersand, at sign, percent, you know, that kind of stuff. So I was just wondering, like, if they had censorship there, like what kind of, I don't know.
As much as I want a Deadpool movie to exist and be good, I don't know how well it would work. Because people who don't know about Deadpool and how his character works, the fourth wall breaking that is necessary, I don't think would go over well. And also having essentially three voices for the same character, I don't think that would go over well with not comic book fans.
Well, I think you could do it. I think the fourth wall breaking doesn't even have to happen. You can have him like look at the camera maybe once or twice, but I don't think that Deadpool doesn't actually need fourth wall breaking. He doesn't need to directly look at the audience and say, "You're watching a movie." He doesn't need to do that. Yeah, what he needs to do is self-reference and talk about him and like talk about it's like, "Oh man, this is like the time I fought Wolverine," or something like that.
Yeah.
Or, man, okay. Like, and I think that the three voices can work if they establish super early on in the movie that he has three voices.
Yes. First scene in the movie.
You know what the first scene of the movie should be if they do a Deadpool movie? Is him telling the story and the same voice going, "This is how this movie, this is how our story," and the same voice going, "No, this is how it happened." And then Deadpool saying, guys, this is how it happened. And then it's told from that story. He has three in his head.
I think the voices would need to be presented kind of like how Scott Pilgrim used a lot of comic, like, they used words a lot on screen and speech bubbles sometimes. Like, I would think, like, speech bubbles would have to be necessary.
Really?
It's like the game. It has to be like the game.
In order for the speech bubbles to come up, the audience to understand. I'm not saying general American audience is stupid. But I think they
It worked with Scott Pilgrim. It can work with Deadpool.
Yeah.
Because Scott Pilgrim had a lot of, like, every character in Scott Pilgrim had a name. Like, it would come up and say, "Scott Pilgrim, age 23-year-old, slacker," or something like that. Or Wallace Wells, 27-year-old, gay roommate, or something like that. Like, so, they could do that with voices.
Yeah. Here's an idea for a non-consequent... The scene wouldn't happen, or... I don't know. Let's say Deadpool's trying to figure out how to bust in somewhere and steal things. I don't know. And he's at a coffee shop. And he's got guns all over the table, eating pancakes or whatever lol random Deadpool is doing. And, it cuts to his face looking at the camera. And then it's like left speech bubble is crazy speech. And right speech bubble is sane. And, as long as we're still centered on Deadpool and he is doing the expressions between sane and crazy, kind of like how it's presented in the video game, I think that would work on screen.
Well, in the comics, how they do it is how they should do it in there, and it's his crazy brain is white speech bubble, black words, and his sane brain is black speech bubble, white words.
Yeah.
It would work that way.
That's
from the comics.
Really?
If you read the comics. His thought bubbles are yellow. He's yellow.
Okay, yeah, right.
And then, like, his sane brain will be black with white.
Yeah.
And then here,
I thought you were saying that one of the speech bubbles was black and white, and the other one was white and black, like black word bubble with white text on it, is what I thought you were talking about.
It's also, like, jagged and smoother, how it's per...
Yeah, but I thought you were talking about different...
But here's what I think. If Ryan Reynolds is playing Deadpool, they should get Nolan North on to do crazy, insane voice. Because I like Nolan North Deadpool voice.
Well,
that's a thought.
There you go.
It's a thought.
I ran out of things to say about Guardians of the Galaxy and the Avengers.
Let's talk about the Avengers 2, and let's talk about Ant-Man real quick.
Okay, Ant-Man. Let's just talk about Ant-Man, and then we'll wrap it up.
And let's talk about the controversy about that, because there is a controversy. There's a controversy because here's the thing about.
Okay.
Let me spill it out real quick. Ultron is the villain of Avengers 2, correct?
Yes.
Right.
Ultron is a creation of Hank Pym, aka Ant-Man.
Isn't he also Giant Man?
He's also Giant Man.
Okay.
Because he changed his particles to where he can grow giant as well as shrink down.
Yeah.
But they call him Ant. Anyway, they're not doing an Ant-Man movie until after Avengers 2.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not introducing Hank Pym. And Joss Whedon, guy who I can go on tangents about for days, both good and bad, has said... No, and people have asked, wait, Ultron's a creation of Hank Pym. How is this going to work? Joss Whedon has said, we're going to make Tony Stark the creator of Ultron.
What? Why? And, like, what does that have to do with... Okay, what does Ultron do first?
Goes, okay, Ultron is a robot, and the biggest point of why he's evil is he has daddy issues because Hank Pym never loved him. He is a sentient robot whose AI has become self-aware, basically.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe they can pull it off. There hasn't been, you know, since there's no more Iron Man movies coming out, they got to make him relevant now somehow, even though everybody loves him anyway.
I don't understand that in Spider-Man 1, they introduced Eddie Brock as a character, and he doesn't pay off for two more movies to turn into Venom. Why couldn't they just offhand reference Hank Pym, maybe a single shot of him?
Here's the thing. There is, it's because what a lot of people think it is because Joss Whedon has said he doesn't like Hank Pym because of one thing that happened a long time ago where Hank Pym, under the stress of being a super scientist who has to deal with saving the world, was like super stressed. He's angry. He doesn't know what to do. He's at the end of his limit. And his wife is the Wasp. The Wasp says, Hank, you need to calm down. And he says, no, I can't. And he flings his arm back and accidentally pimp slaps her, pretty much.
I think I've seen that frame somewhere.
And people think that and that's why Joss Whedon says he doesn't like Ant-Man, is because he hit his wife one time, and apparently that makes him a wife beater.
Okay, so who's Joss Whedon, real quick? Is that Ultron?
Joss Whedon is the guy who directs the movies. He's the guy Marvel has made and has hired to direct every single.
So he doesn't like movie. Ant-Man.
He doesn't like the character.
Here's the thing. Edgar Wright, the guy who made Shaun of the Dead, At World's End, Hot Fuzz, those movies with Simon Pegg, he's going to be directing the Ant-Man movie. Because Ant-Man's a silly character anyway, pretty much.
Yeah, controls.
He controls ants. That's one of his powers.
Yeah.
Is it really?
Yeah. He has a helmet that lets him talk to bugs.
I thought that he just changes his size and can lift many times his own head.
He can, but still.
But he can still change his size. Him.
Here's the thing: is he can change his size to big or small.
He can change his size to suit his mood.
Pretty much, and he has a helmet that lets him control ants and robots.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I made a very vague reference to the DK rap from Donkey Kong.
I got the reference.
Okay.
Donkey Kong.
Okay, go on.
Donkey Ant. But yeah, and that's a problem for me because I like Hank Pym as a character. He's one of the smartest people in the Marvel Universe. And really the whole point about Ultron is his whole character is based on his relationship with Hank Pym. So if you don't have Hank Pym,
then what's the point?
How can you have that relationship with Ultron?
Yeah, that's kind of weird. And instead it's just going
to
be...
They're going to have to write some bullshit reason why he's evil.
Yeah. Okay, what is Ultron's superpower then? You said he was a robot that can what?
He's a robot that he can use Hank Pym's robot controlling powers, and he can make more robots, and he has like death rays and a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, he's like
That sounds more akin to Iron Man's stuff.
He's a super weapon, basically.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess that kind of makes sense for Iron Man to make him, but I guess his character is thrown out.
It doesn't make sense because he didn't make him.
Did you just listen to what I said? I said I guess that makes kind of his personality why he's thrown out the window.
Well, Tony Stark just wrote bad programming.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, go on, Hayden.
It can work that Iron Man does make him, that he made a robot and then abandoned it and said, I'm not going to deal with this robot anymore because it's a failure or something like that. And then Ultron can become self-aware and say and think that Tony Stark is his father and think that he failed his father and get super teenage angsty. And that's why he goes evil. But that doesn't have the same effect as Hank Pym, where Hank Pym built Ultron and then basically raised him for years until he decided this isn't working out.
Yeah.
And by that time, Ultron had already become self-aware and thought of Hank Pym as a father because Hank Pym seemed to care about him until he said, this isn't working out.
Huh.
And then went on to, because he made Ultron, depending on which canon it is, he made Ultron before or after he started his working on his size-changing powers.
Yeah.
So in one story, he made Ultron and then thought spent time with him and then thought Ultron was a failure and then went to work on his next project, which was his particle powers, to make himself smaller or larger, and then just forgot about Ultron, and that's why Ultron has become evil.
Wow.
Because he feels abandoned and this wants to lash out at the world.
That's freaking weird. I want to read Ant-Man now. I want to get into that. Is it Ant-Man? Is that part of the Ant-Man comics, or is that just...
There are Ant-Man comics. There's Ant-Man. There's a bunch of stuff. But Ant-Man was original. And that's the thing I don't like about the Avengers movie, is that Ant-Man was one of the original Avengers.
Yeah. He's an Ultimate Avengers, the cartoon.
Yeah, but he was one of the original. Captain America, instead of Captain America, it was Ant-Man and Wasp.
Mm-hmm.
Thor, Iron Man, the Hulk, Ant-Man, and Wasp is who it was. There was no Captain America. There was no Hawkeye. There was no Black Widow.
I really
those
think
characters. Captain there was there wasn't the best, even though. There wasn't even a Nick Fury at that time.
Wow.
Well, there was a Nick Fury, but he wasn't. There was, but S.H.I.E.L.D. had nothing to do with the Avengers.
He was also white.
Yes, but it makes sense in the movies why he's black and why he's Samuel Jackson is because when they made the Ultimate Universe, they said, hey, Samuel Jackson, we want to reboot the Marvel Universe in a separate universe to show different stories.
Mm-hmm.
And they asked Samuel Jackson to use his likeness. And he said, okay, as long as I get to play Nick Fury in the movies, because he was a big Nick Fury fan.
Yeah.
And he said, oh, if you're making Nick Fury in this new universe look like me, I want to be him in the movies. And they said, sure, why not? And then they used Nick Fury looking like Samuel Jackson in the...
It's kind of what happened with Mace Windu, wasn't it? With the purple lightsaber.
Pretty much. Yeah.
He's just like, well, if I'm going to be in this movie, I want this. And they're like, oh yeah, you can have it. You're Samuel L. Jackson.
And he's like, there better not be any snakes on my plane. Or yeah. I'll have to have a Royale cheese. And there's dinosaurs.
And hold on. I was about to say, and hold on to your butts.
And the raptors have learned to open the doors.
Please! God damn it, I hate the second crap.
God.
Oh, Samuel Jackson. I love Samuel Jackson.
Me too.
I don't like him as much as Nick Cage, but he's pretty good.
Nicolas Cage.
He is a great actor. Tell me one Nicolas Cage movie you did not enjoy.
I hope Nicolas Cage is the Ant-Man. That'd be awesome.
Oh, Hayden, have I told you about my Avengers reboot?
No, but I have to tell Phil something. I have to tell Phil something real quick. Nicolas Cage, sadly, is not Ant-Man. They're getting Paul Rudd to be Ant-Man.
Who is Paul Rudd? I remember that name. Who is
that? He was in the movie Grown Ups. He's a comedian.
Hold on, I'm looking at
him.
You know Grown Ups 2 has a 7% on Rotten Tomatoes?
Oh wait, not Grown Ups, not Grown Ups. What's it called? He's in Anchorman.
Oh yeah.
Too.
Man, and, I know that guy. What was that movie?
What was that movie he was in? It was not Grown Ups. It was something like that.
He's in a movie though. Yes.
He's in several movies.
I know. I'm just.
He's in a lot of funny movies, and that's good for Ant-Man. Is a funny character, unless he's going crazy and accidentally hits his wife.
I know his name. I know what he looks like.
Role models. Role models.
I don't recognize any of these things he was in. None of them.
You don't recognize 40-Year-Old Virgin or Anchorman or...
Phil doesn't watch movies.
Phil doesn't watch movies.
What the heck?
Sad.
Anyway. Yeah, it's a sad day for a non-movie watcher when you're making movie references. I'm like, huh? Guardians of the Galaxy? What's that? Avengers? I'm just going to pretend like I know what I'm talking about.
Oh. Hey.
You said Avengers reboot, Truman.
Yeah. I watched The Avengers, and I was like, I'm going to recast this movie to make it the best movie ever.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, tell them about that.
I'm trying to remember who all I picked. I know for a fact that I had Michael Cera as Captain America.
It would work.
Finally, the role he was born for.
Yeah.
I know that Bruce Banner was played by Louis C.K.
Yes.
Stop right there.
Whoa, this it gets
already,
better.
This is already the best movie I've ever seen.
Yeah. Keep going.
I honestly don't remember. Oh,
Nicolas Cage. You had Nicolas Cage
is Tony Stark.
Yes.
Okay. This is the best movie I've ever seen.
I honestly
heard.
Don't remember the rest of them. Oh my Nick God. Fury.
Is who is Chris?
What?
Who is Christopher Walken? You had Christopher Walken in there.
Was it Loki? Did I have Loki as Christopher?
Maybe. I don't remember.
Thor,
but...
my brother. You're not my brother, Thor. You
got the Tesseract.
I am an Earth giant, and you are an Asgardian.
But Samuel L. Jackson is still Nick Fury. That's not changing.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Never mind. Hawkeye and Black Widow don't count.
No, they don't care.
But who's Thor?
Danny DeVito. No, I don't remember.
Okay. If that was Christopher Walken, that'd be awesome.
No, it's Ron Perlman. That's who it should be.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I love Ron Perlman.
Yeah.
Ron Perlman and Christopher Walken. He's like, Ron Perlman's like Loki, you gotta stop this. Come home, brother. I'm not your brother, Thor. Oh,
I'm not your brother.
Why don't you go back to hell?
From which you
boy?
Came?
No, what he should say is he should say to what Christopher Walken should say to Ron Perlman, Thor, is why don't you go back to hell, boy? You get it?
Yeah.
It's Ron Perlman.
Yep. Hellboy 2 is really good.
You know what they need to make Hellboy 3.
You know what they need to make? You know the Goon.
Yes. Yes. You know what they need to make? That Goon-Hellboy crossover.
You know what they need to make?
The Goon-Hellboy crossover.
Ninja Turtles again.
They're doing that.
They are. And Michael the Ninja Bay. Turtles are going to be aliens. Anglicans.
That's stupid.
Thanks, Obama.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not any less stupid than Rocket Raccoon being an alien.
No,
that's what I'm saying. I hate it when people say, oh, the universe is completely infinite. There's a million different possibilities. These people just happen to look exactly like us, and every single alien just happens to look exactly like us and animals we have here. It's like, come on, use your imagination.
Was what they imagined. That there's an infinite. They imagined an infinitely possible universe, Phil.
I know.
Infinitely possible. They imagined that.
But we never get any characters that look fucking crazy with eyeballs and tentacles and, you know, crazy stuff like that. All we get are raccoons and normal things. Nothing out of the ordinary. A human with a human
Phil.
Head. Oh, I haven't seen that from Star Wars Episode 1. Sorry, what?
But Phil, you have to understand, Rocket Raccoon was written from the ground up to be an alien. The Ninja Turtles are an existing license that they were mutants.
But I'm saying that them rewriting Rocket Raccoon a raccoon from Earth experimented makes more sense.
No, it doesn't.
Then, hold on, what am I saying here?
But Phil, you have to also understand, I said earlier, the Marvel Universe, when they get to space, logic flies out the window.
Okay.
They can have raccoons if they want.
Ninja Turtles in space now.
That's not Marvel.
They can have Tanukis in space.
Don't you mean raccoon dogs?
Don't you mean Tony the Chopper?
You know, if we would just start saying Tanuki instead of raccoon dog, eventually we would learn what those are and stop dancing around the subject. They're Tanukis. They're a thing. Not really a thing, but they exist in Japanese culture.
They exist in real life. They just don't.
Oh yeah,
like the myth.
They're
says
not the mythical beasts.
They're not the shapeshifters.
Like that movie Pompoko, which is pretty good until the end. Except it has Jonathan
just
Taylor
like...
Thomas in it.
That's just
tool terrible. Time.
Tool.
You know, old.
I've heard the argument that I agree with, that Home Improvement would have been a way better show if the show was just Tool Time.
Yeah, no, I would watch Tool Time.
Not Home Improvement. Just
yeah, knowing Tool it's Time. Like a crazy spoof to make fun of TV.
Yeah, it was the same shit for 8 seasons. Oh, you get to watch those kids you don't care about evolve.
I remember watching Home Improvement on TV and, like, waiting for Tool Time to happen in an episode.
I just liked Wilson. That was the only part about not Tool Time that I liked. Just the fact that there was a guy who you never see his whole face, and you're like, what's the rest of his face? How come you never see his whole face? What's the deal with that? That's the only thing. And I was, like, freaking little. I just remembered a time where I'd see, like, pieces of his face, and I was able to piece it together, and I was like, oh, my God, that's what he looks like? And after that, I wasn't interested anymore. Go on.
There was a picture I saw, and it was of Wilson, like, looking over the fence, and, like, it said, on that day, Tim Allen received a grim reminder.
Oh, yeah.
Attack on Tool Time.
Attack on Tim.
On that.
I like parodies of the Attack on Titan theme song more than the actual show. I'm just gonna say that. Have you seen the?
Do either of you know what Cookie Clicker is?
Yeah, my roommate played it until he won.
I know it's a type of game.
Someone made a parody.
Sorry?
Someone made a parody where it's called Attack on, like, it's Attack on Cookie, and it's just like the theme song, except they, like, took, like, the sprites from Cookie Clicker and put them on it.
Okay. There's also a, a Breaking Bad version of Cookie Clicker.
That's what I played.
Clicking Bad.
Yeah, Clicking Bad is what it was.
Your meth has reached space. Your meth has been distributed throughout the galaxy. Everyone loves meth in the galaxy.
Yep, everyone. Even Groot. Even Rocket Raccoon. Even Groot.
I'm Rocket Raccoon is fueled by meth. Spoiler.
What were you saying, Truman?
I'm interested to see how Groot plays out, because he only has one line of dialogue.
I am Groot. Does he ever speak in different languages, or?
I don't know. Hayden's a fan of the series.
He's Groot.
Does he speak different languages other than English?
I believe so. I don't really remember. It's been a while since I read Guardian of the Galaxy.
Okay.
But he is Groot.
All I know is that recently there was a spinoff because the Guardians of the Galaxy and the comics broke up for a while.
Yeah.
And there's been a spinoff where all it is Rocket Raccoon and Groot.
That's pretty cool. Those are the only two cool ones anyway.
Does Raccoon live in Groot's tree branches? Like a
pretty much. Pretty much.
Awesome.
That's amazing.
Just hangs out with Groot. He just hangs out with Groot and then comes out to shoot things.
Does Groot shoot things?
No, Groot's the muscle.
Yeah.
He
can control trees.
Really? Like Ant-Man controls ants and Aquaman controls the aqua?
Groot helps Treebeard and his fellow treants throw rocks at orcs and Saruman.
Oh, like the black and red guy in the picture. Who's
that guy's
Rocket Raccoon and Groot.
That guy's really cool. That's Drax.
Drax is the destroyer.
He's actually
Drax. He's a space orc.
Okay, there you go.
And he uses daggers. That's his
space trees, thing. Space raccoon, space orc, space man, and space She-Hulk.
It's space Brett Macklin, Phil, not space man.
Sorry,
it's Brett Macklin. It's Phil J. Fry.
Space.
This is the Futurama movie we've all been waiting for.
I'm sad Futurama's
also,
over.
She's too
sad
short.
Futurama's over.
That's over.
I'm sad Futurama came back.
I don't know.
I thought the first 4 seasons were gold, and then the new seasons were funny, but
yeah,
they were
pretty good.
But they were more hit and miss. When the old stuff was always there was always something there. And the new ones were like, oh, this one's funny, but this one's not.
They could have kept Futurama going like The Simpsons.
Yeah, I was gonna say I didn't want Futurama to turn into The Simpsons, but I wasn't ready for it to be finished. I want some new Futurama.
Poor Truman.
I wish they would, you know, maybe in a couple years they'll release another movie. I'd be okay with that.
Please no.
I like the movies.
They ended where they should have ended.
Yeah, I know they did.
Maybe a movie that takes place like in the middle of the series. Well,
that's whenever they
sort of like the Full Metal Alchemist movies that come out when Al isn't still a suit of armor.
The movies of Futurama were like, we're not definitely sure the series is coming back, so we're going to have vague conclusions to these stories.
Well, the thing about the Futurama movies is that they had the licenses to all four, but at the end of the fourth one, they had no idea what was going to go on. So that's why they ended it where they went to that wormhole where either A, they could go to that wormhole, oh, we're back on Earth, let's start the new series, or B, we went through a wormhole and we have no idea what happened.
Yeah.
That's just where it ends. So.
And that, I mean, it's not the greatest ending, but that also worked. And then they're like, whoa, came out of the wormhole and we're back on Earth. Three more seasons.
Whoa.
Yep.
That is what happened.
Sounds good. You ready to bring this episode to a grinding halt?
Stop everything. It's over.
Well, I have one more thing to recommend to you guys.
Okay.
It's another anime. Like I said, watch Fooly Cooly. Watch. Not One Piece. You. I'm pretty sure you guys already know what One Piece is.
One Piece is the best.
But the people who don't know what One Piece is, go read One Piece if you don't know it. I said to people who are listening to this and don't know what One Piece is, go read or watch One Piece.
There's a reason it's number one in the world.
It is number read one it. In the world.
Read it. Anyway.
Anyway, I was going to say, you guys should watch Fooly Cooly. You should watch Gurren Lagann, and you should watch Kill la Kill. But there's one more you should watch that, well, I'm not saying recommend it. It's not Sergeant Frog. It's a show that many people describe as, the only way to describe it is fabulous, but in a good way, I guess.
Is it Space Dandy?
It's not Space Dandy. It's JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Okay.
I'll check it out.
And if you don't know what JoJo's Bizarre Adventure is, it's described as fabulous because they do poses and stuff, but it's a pretty action-y shonen.
What about Bobo?
Not Mr. Bobo. It's way more fabulous than Mr. Two and Bobo combined.
Yeah, Mr. Two Bon Clay is pretty fabulous.
It's pretty much what if Bon Clay, Ivankov, and Goku had a baby. That's pretty much
oh,
what
man.
It is.
That sounds pretty freaking fabulous.
Fabulous.
If I say so myself.
But like,
yeah.
But it's not like outwardly gay. Let's just get that out of the way. Fabulous means kind of gay. But it's not outwardly gay.
It's just a little bit fruity.
Just fruity. Fabulous. That's why I say fabulous.
Feminine. Not necessarily.
Feminine.
Attracted to the same gender.
That's pretty much what I'm talking about. In
touch with your feminine side.
Yeah.
Like no, I'm talking about men who are like really like muscly and they show a lot of skin and they wear tight clothing and they do poses when they fight.
I have not had a problem with any of those things you've listed so far. So
yeah, me neither.
So it's
the best.
But it's over. It's
why like, do you think JoJo's we like bizarre. Superheroes so much?
Yeah, I like spandex a lot.
But it's great. It's ridiculous. It's over the top, and until it got an anime recently, it was the longest running manga series that had no anime because it started in the 80s, and they just like gave it, and they just gave it an anime like last year, and they only did like the first two parts, and then they're gonna do the third part sometime this year.
Yeah.
So I'd recommend JoJo. JoJo, it's funny to watch just because it's over the top ridiculous, just like everything else I've said, Gurnlagan and all those, but it's ridiculous on a different level. But it's not stupid, was what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Chimichangas are ridiculous, but they're stupid. These are ridiculous, like, oh, that's hype! Like, does that kind of ridiculous.
Okay.
Also, all of the characters are named after bands. There's a character named Robert Edward Oswald Speedwagon.
What about Metallica?
Is there a guy named Guns N' Roses?
I think so. Later on, there's a character named Cars. There's a character named Vanilla Ice.
I'm okay with all of this.
Me too.
But the thing is, it takes place. Each, like, the manga has taken place, like, over spans of, like, decades. And, it keeps changing protagonists. The first two parts follow the same protagonist, which is Joseph Joestar. Mm-hmm. And then that's part one and two. Then the second one is, the third part is Jotaro Joestar. And it's called JoJo's Bizarre Adventure because even though it changes protagonists, all of their names can be read as JoJo.
Oh, okay.
It's like spelled like G-I-O, but his name's Giovanni. You can read it like JoJo, even though it's spelled G-I-O.
Yeah. Okay.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah. No, I've been trying to broaden my anime viewing, because as awesome as One Piece is, I need to have more than one trick ponies in my...
Bag of ponies.
Yeah. So, I've been watching Bebop, and I'm wanting to watch Toriko, and I've been watching Kill la Kill.
I got caught up in Bleach, Naruto, and Fairy Tail, and I hate every one of them.
You gotta watch.
I hate all three of them.
Well, here's the thing.
Okay, let me tell you. Naruto started out so freaking good, it enrages me that it got so bad. Bleach, it was kind of to begin with. It was good in the middle, and then it went at the end. And then Fairy Tales has a lot of awesome concepts, but never uses them, and they're stupid. What is that?
Yeah, that's the problem with Fairy Tale. It has a lot of cool stuff, but it never does anything with it.
Yeah.
But the problem with Naruto and Bleach is that filler killed it.
Yeah.
They were killed.
I'm talking about the manga. I'm specifically talking about.
Oh, you're
manga.
Reading the manga? Oh.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing about Bleach. There's nothing good about Bleach except for the anime filler. The anime filler is the only good thing about Bleach.
Yeah, it was like I read the manga of Bleach and I was like, whatever, like the drawing style kind of was lame. There was no backgrounds ever drawn. Ever. Not right now. Somebody's trying to come into my room. Anyway. We've been a weird silent moment. Allison, stop! Or is that Dad?
Guest star.
Okay, this isn't even an important part of the check. I'm doing a show right now. I'm recording.
This is all staying in.
Okay. She handed me like the part of the check that you have to rip off when you put the check.
The stub?
Yeah, the stub, the part that you don't need. She just thought that was important, so she just handed it to me and I was like, this isn't, you could have thrown this away. I wouldn't have minded. Anyway, what was I saying? Bleach. It's like the terrible pages have been bleached. The just white backgrounds and characters drawn as, you know, no expression, just kind of like rigid cardboard cutouts. That's what they are, just standing around talking. The anime is better than the manga on that one.
Yeah, because at least those pictures move around.
Yeah, and they're colored in, and they have backgrounds.
And most of it's filler, which is actually better than the actual story.
Yeah, I know. And, you know,
and Naruto...
Bleach just got to the climax, and the anime just cut it off because nobody gave a shit.
Yeah, that's the thing about... No, Bleach, like the anime, it went so long, they said, this isn't making enough money, so we're cutting you off, we don't care.
Yeah.
It wasn't making enough money for them to produce, so they're like, we don't care if you make a lot, if you're like one of the big three mangas out there. We don't care anymore.
And that's only for America, too. Like, nobody in Japan gives a shit about Bleach. Like, everyone... Yeah, like, Japan, like, dropped it, and nobody there cared. But then everyone in America went apeshit, because they were like, that's like all I watch in anime. That's like the best thing there is. It's like nothing else that I have or pay attention to. Because One Piece looks like it's for babies because it's all colorful. And everyone knows that colors are for babies.
Interesting to look at and different.
And cartoony. And that's just stupid. I want rigid cardboard cutouts.
I want the CBS of anime. I want it to be bland and boring.
Pretty much. Another thing about One Piece, though, is I think a lot of people still remember the four kids version.
Yeah.
I gotta say, the Funimation version isn't that much better, though. Luffy sounds like a
child. No, shut up. The Funimation's great. Funimation version.
Don't defend. Okay, yeah, there are some good
Funimation. I will defend it.
Phil, four kids and Funimation.
We're not weighing four kids against it.
Funimation is so much better.
Voice acting in general, there are better voice actors for, you know, Funimation's, you know, Fullmetal Alchemist series. There's better voice actors for Funimation's fucking Naruto series, in my opinion, than One Piece. I think that the voice actors for One Piece are not that great. Sorry.
Naruto's not licensed by Funimation.
Boom!
I did not know that.
It's not, sorry. But, I actually do like the One Piece four kids.
Luffy, Usopp, Chopper, their voices suck. And they ruin everything.
Their voices fit the characters. Their voices fit the
characters. No, they don't.
If you compared Usopp in Japanese to Usopp in English, they are horribly different characters.
They are. Usopp, like, had a relatable, human side to him. And in the,
English.
Yeah, and there were you could hear the,
character?
You know what I mean? The, hesitation in the lies that he said in the, Japanese version. Like, you know, like, I am the king of, you know, all this stuff. And, you know, he didn't sound like just, I am the king of thousand people.
Well, Phil, how far did you watch into it? The Funimation one, yeah.
A lot.
How far?
Truman and I watched a marathon.
I've still been watching on Toonami since I brought it back. I watch it weekly.
Yeah,
I just cry every time.
I marathoned it. Yeah, I marathoned it with Truman during the Water 7 arc. And we tried to watch Strong World together, the new movie that they dubbed that's been around for a while, and we just couldn't. We couldn't listen.
Dad was cringing. Bill's having issues.
I was cringing. Dad was like, "What the fuck is that?" And then we changed it to Japanese. And I asked him if that was better, and he's like, "That's much better because Luffy's just screaming from the top of its lungs the whole fucking time with the gravelly ass like gunk in his throat that like he never has in the Japanese version." It's like, you know, like, he sounds absolutely excited. It's like, hey, what's going on? Whatever. And then in the English version, he's like,
see,
Let me say something.
State your piece.
He sounds, to me, he sounds like that in the Japanese version. He sounds like, in the English version, Phil, calm down. Different strokes for different folks. I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying, to me, I do like the Japanese version. I think that they're both equal, but I feel like I want to support Funimation's version of One Piece because it's English, it's One Piece in America, and it needs to recover from four kids. I don't think you understand how bad four kids ruined One Piece for the American audience.
I did. I think it's like a million times worse, but I still think Funimation's Luffy, Usopp, and Chopper are bad, and because of that, I find it hard to listen to because all of the other Japanese version are absolutely perfect.
But you know who was great in the Funimation version? Crocodile.
Yes.
That's all that matters.
Except he's not in
Shut up. It was good enough.
I love Funimation stuff. I just think that those three characters are so bad that I can't keep watching the show. with them chiming in every once in a while.
Can I? Really...
That's okay.
Okay,
Phil.
I'm just saying I prefer.
I'm just saying
One more thing.
Can I be part of this conversation?
Different strokes for different folks.
Yes, you can, Truman. Hold on.
Just a second. Just a second. You said different strokes for different folks. Yes. I'm just saying I prefer soft, gentle strokes with velvet, while you prefer needly brushes with made of metal and nails.
What I'm saying is I'm a red-blooded American who likes my heroes to be boisterous, is what I'm saying.
And voiced by
screaming children.
Can I say my opinion real quick?
Yes,
you can.
I do side with Phil on the Japanese being better, and it's sometimes I feel like I'm just being a purist.
Just Luffy, Usopp, and Chopper.
I'm not saying I could watch 600 episodes and put up with Luffy and Chopper's voice, but Usopp is literally like my favorite character in anything that's ever existed. When you start messing with him, that's where I have issues. I can't stand how much I feel Usopp is getting the short end of the stick in English. And my other thing is, a lot of characters have uninspired voices in English, like Franky, and he's just gruff male. Zoro is just gruff male.
Yeah, but Franky at least is good in the English version. I'm not saying he's not good in the Japanese version, but I'm saying I feel like they did him at least right enough.
He actually had personality, style in his voice in the Japanese version. I think in the English they took away a lot of that.
I think in Japanese
Let Truman put in his bit. We've been back and forth yapping for a while.
I think the Japanese voice actors are as unique as the characters themselves. I mean, there's probably like tertiary characters that don't matter that may be similar, but you listen to everybody and they all have a unique voice that fits a character, and I don't think they transition that well enough in English.
I agree with
that. Well, here's another thing you have to understand. Funimation has only like got 50 people. Japan, it's a whole industry in Japan. They have different. They can go on the street and say, "Hey, you want to be a voice actor?" And if their chops are good enough, they will give them the role. They will give them the role, and that will be their only role for that character. That's all they do.
And it pays off in America.
But in America, it's not as big as an industry, so they have to cut corners, and they say, oh, Chris Sabat, you have to voice Vegeta, and they have to voice this guy, and they have to voice this guy. And I think that's the reason why it might seem uninspired, is because you've heard those people so many times before.
Well, right. I mean, there are American voice actors who have very large ranges in their voices. So.
But they don't normally go into voice anime to redub things.
I'm not saying that isn't a valid point. I just think...
Because of that point.
There are English voice actors who can do that.
And I'm going to say because of that point, because they are limited, it's not as good. Not inspired, but the voices aren't... Just because there's an excuse for the voices not being as good, it doesn't mean that it's more likable to listen to. That's what I'm saying.
If you have two coloring sheets, and on one you can use 300 crayons, and the other one you can only use 60, probably the 300 crayon one's going to look nicer because there's more depth in colors and nuances and stuff. Not saying that the 60 crayon coloring isn't bad, it's just not as good.
And also, it's not going to make me like the...
And there's 60. Also way too much hot pink in the 600 crayon one that just hurts your eyes when you're looking at it.
You mean the 60?
In the 60, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
I'd say there's too much hot pink in all of them, but... There's 20 crayons that are hot pink in the 60. There's 200 that are hot pink in the 600. Anyway, what I'm saying is I understand that. I respect the Japanese versions. I understand they're different. I'm just saying that I do like the official English ones. I like them because mainly because I can like put on an episode of One Piece that's like filler and just listen to it and do something else. And I can still get the story, like, I'm listening to it. Because it's one, because what I'm saying is, I only do this with filler arcs, by the way. Filler is filler.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm saying is, I like it because I'm someone who, I'm kind of busy whenever I watch anime. So I might be watching something, but I might have to look away for a moment. And I can not miss something if they say
that
something
makes
important.
Sense.
Yeah, but
so just have, what I'm saying is for me personally, yeah. I enjoy it because of a variety of reasons. I'm not saying you're wrong when you say that the Japanese versions are better for the reasons you stated, like they have more diversity. I'm just saying that I prefer the English voices because of the way I watch anime.
Yeah,
that's fine.
I love being engrossed for 22 minutes.
Yeah,
devoting
me too.
To be in that story.
Yeah. Where 10 minutes of that 20 minutes is what happened the previous episode.
Yeah.
Oh, well, no.
If it was a week ago, then that's fine.
That's my problem. No, unless you binge it and it's still...
Oh, yeah, well...
Okay, yeah.
You can cut down an episode
of
One Piece into about 18 minutes.
Yeah.
You cut theme songs and the little, like, here's where we're at in the story intro to every episode.
All right. So, Truman, to wrap up this ending,
end
of this episode... will you know, the first line Luffy has in the show, what a great nap. Can you take the Japanese clip of that and just play it, and then the English clip of that and just play it, and have the viewers decide which one's better?
Possibly.
Do you think you'll be able to do that?
With the YouTube controversy right here about right claims.
Just, not the show, not the, like, you know, you don't have
in
to
the
show
the
audio
it.
Is
just
copyright.
Just the audio. Just the audio.
Audio's copyright.
No, the audio is still copyright. Well, try to find them and put them in the show notes. And
yeah,
say,
I'll
and say
to YouTube videos or something that are posting. But yeah, we want to hear from people. What
Which
they
one
think?
Two?
Do you side with me, or do you side with Phil and
the
Truman?
Correct side.
Because
the Chatmen. Do you side with the
I'm not.
Guestman
do you side with
the
Chatmen or the Guestman? Do you side with the Weeaboos, or do you side with the American?
Whoa, we're not Weeaboos.
Yeah, I'm Captain.
We don't want to be Japanese culture. We just know it exists.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
Oh, another thing though is another anime I want to recommend real quick. Because I like recommending things when I get to talk to large audiences.
Our audiences are large. It's just man.
It's fine. It's
you're recommending.
I like
stuff
recommending
to yourself.
Yes, I like recommending stuff to myself. Anyway, aside from Kill la Kill, Gurren Lagann, JoJo, and
Cooly
Cooly, and not Bobo. I'm never recommending Bobo unless you like that kind of crap. I would also recommend a series that also came out recently, like in the last season,
mm-hmm.
which was one of my favorite slice of life mangas. Its shortening is Watamote, but its long title is No Matter How I Look at It, It's Not My Fault I'm Not Popular, and it is the most. It is. It's one of the funniest, most cringe-inducing slice-of-life mangas ever, and it is hilarious.
All right, well...
So go watch Watamote.
And all the other things.
And all the other things.
So,
but Watamote's funny because a rundown of it is it's a girl character, and she's basically an otaku. She has no social life, and she's wondering... She's trying to become popular, and she blames everyone else, and she has no idea how to interact with people, so she's, like, really nervous and shy, and, like, whenever she, like tries to interact with someone, she's like, oh, no, I can't do it, and, like, it's really, like, closed off, and then after, like, the things happen, she's like, oh, that person was such a jerk, but it's so funny because it's just her failing, and it gets funnier and funnier how more disillusioned she gets.
All right. What was that, Truman?
We have... I'm going to call it a tradition. This is the third Guestman episode, where we let the Guestman do the sign-off for the episode. And real quick, I apologize to everybody. This episode is going to be like 2.5+ hours. So if you stuck around, you're going to get to hear Hayden, our Guestman, sign off. So go ahead. Give it a go.
Well, I hope everyone enjoyed this episode of The Guest Chatmen. I hope people enjoyed my recommendation. And I hope people will side with me on the whole dubbing versus original Japanese issue. And please, please, tune in next time and all the times afterwards to The Chatmen, because it's such a great show.
Oh,
I'm Hayden, so nice. And I'd like to say thank you for listening if you got this far. And hopefully I'll see you sometime in future if they ever let me back.
Yeah.
And hopefully they'll see you in like 3 weeks or 1 year.
Oh, good. That cut off. Say that last
sentence. Yeah.
Also, hopefully Happy we'll New Year. See you.
All right.
I mean, hopefully me.
All right.
No. We'll see you guys later.
Bye. See you, kids.